Twice upon a time they sat, a buoyant, boisterous wreck. The toppling of a steepled roof, the rope which wrings a neck. She makes a call, he waited when, confronted with their deaths. Towards the fire light they drew, through vetted fickle breaths. And so it comes and came to see, that what came four will end at three. And leave and yet return again, escape the coop, but not the pen. The waste of time yield answer still, will washed up men call to fulfill, still waiting on the cannon fire, as flames lick neath old Bannon's pyre. The red eyes of its charcoal skin, the kid lay waiting for its kin, a herald one could call it yet, with mind of man and leash of pet. And what will come of all this choice, she asked with bated breath. The end is not the end, it seems, yet its name still sounds as death. But did hell follow with him? Eric woke with the sun that shone brightly through his bedroom window. He lay there for a long time, staring at the ceiling. His most recent dream running over and over in his mind like a record that kept skipping. After a long beat, he shook his head and sat up to the edge of his bed, and after a moment, walked to the window. The grassy driveway was becoming overgrown. Soon he'd need to cut it, he thought. However, he'd wait until Dad asked. No sense in making work for himself. The dreams he had of late were becoming more and more vivid, more and more real, as if suddenly a sharp pain shot through his head. His eyes fluttered. He put a hand on the small window to steady himself as he pressed his fingers against his temple. White hot fire flashed behind his eyes as an excruciating pain burned through his mind. He fell to his knees, tears in his eyes as images ripped through his mind, as if something within him was being torn apart. He swore he could hear his skull cracking and twisting as his ears stung with a high-pitched whine that consumed him entirely until it stopped. Eric stood up, a confused expression on his face, which quickly washed off to realization. As if he had done it a thousand times, he left his room, walked down the stairs, past his father's office, out the front door, down the porch, and began off into the woods. His mind felt clear for the first time, as if it all came rushing back to him. By the time he arrived at the outcropping of houses in the woods, he was smiling. He walked to the center of the houses, some destroyed, a few half standing, as he sat on the soft dirt before the tall white church. He waited a long beat before the rustling of the trees sounded behind him. He knew she was there. He knew she would come to find him. She approached, and without turning his back to her, he said, in that same cold, flat tone he had yet to use, he said, "I remember everything." She stood behind him, unmoving, and began to cry.
Hello all, and welcome back to the Invictus Stream. My name, as always, is Mr. Harlan Guthrie, and I am here with my very best friend, Mr. Michael Matty Matt Michaels. Mr. Justin Georgie Whitman. And Chris Tamarack Moonshine. And we are here with GRIMM Chapter 3, Death and the Lady. This is, of course, an 18 plus show. So if you don't feel like you are mature enough to deal with the very dark, decrepit underbelly that we're about to dive into, then you go ahead and you close this video. But before you do, please give it a big thumbs up. In fact, if you're watching in any capacity, whether you're listening to this on the podcast, which you wouldn't hear this part because we cut it out, but if you're listening in any capacity, you go to the YouTube video and you give it a like because it makes us feel really, really special. It makes Justin want to
sing. I want to sing about the likes of the Invictus community.
And it makes Chris want to
not sing after Justin.
So yeah, if you're watching this,
got a laugh track.
Yeah. Finally!
So if you like this, or if you're watching this video, please like it on YouTube. It makes us really, really, it makes us get all the money. It's all the money. It goes into a big pile and we get to run around naked into it.
Woo! Intimate.
And some of us look better naked than others, let me tell you.
That's who it is.
Also, if you are watching this, share the video too. If you're really enjoying this game or any of our games, please go ahead and share it. We just found out we have the very privileged distinction. I don't know the word. Our Deadlands campaign, our Call of Cthulhu game, as well as The Strange. When you search them on YouTube, you know, Deadlands RPG, it's our videos are the first ones that come up. And that was a really, really happy thing for us to be there. I don't know why, but
them.
I'm happy that's there.
Them? The people watching.
The people watching!
It's you guys! It's you all along!
You did it!
Thank you so much!
No, but thank you so much, legitimately. So that is very awesome. So if you like our videos or you have yet to see any of our videos, share it. Check it out. We'd love to spread the word. Of course, we are on Twitter as well, at Invictus Stream. So go ahead and follow us there. And most importantly, join the Facebook group and like the Facebook page. The Facebook page you can find by searching the Invictus Stream in Facebook. And you can also join the group the same way. The group is where we get together and we talk throughout the week. We hang out. We post videos there. We chat. We share stories about RPGs. We watch other people's stories unfold. Mike Fazio, whose birthday just passed. Happy birthday, buddy. He was very excited because he just got to run his first game of End of the World and it went swimmingly. So well done, Mike. Very proud of you. Happy to have helped you in any small way that we could have. And there's many stories like that. So if you enjoy sharing stories or you just want to hang out, come to the Invictus Stream group page. It's where all the cool, it's where we get make shit up. What's the tagline? What's our thing?
We make shit up.
Where we make shit up, yeah. Also, yeah, Mike Kyle just shared a story there that he wrote as well, which is fantastic. A lot of great stuff. In fact, when you post there, you have a chance to win MVP. And MVP gives you 1 XP to spend in-game to change the way we play. Without further ado, I'm going to throw it to my best boyfriend, Mr. Matty Michaels, a.k.a. Michael. God, you have a confusing name. To to read off the MVP for this week and give someone a little bit of reward.
Thank you. Gosh, yeah, I'm really excited about doing this. Thank you, Harlan. I got, this is so radical. This is so cool. Super cool. I just want to say that we get a lot of great posts, and it's fun really reading everything you guys contribute, but we're going to be a little bit self-indulgent here because we are, it's really weird. We're four individual megalomaniacs, and it's hard to see the world revolve around each of us individually, but somehow it works. This week is going to go to someone who put a lot of time and thought and effort into this and put a lot of things down that we never thought of. You can check it out on the Invictus Reddit stream. So thank you to Miss Aisha D. Lyle and her post on Let's Talk About the Game Before the Next One Comes.
Double clap. Yeah, Aisha did a fantastic job of collecting the information that's happened over the last two chapters and sort of offering suggestions and leads for these guys to follow up on. So, well done, Aisha. You win the MVP. So, well done.
Yeah, and again, I just want to jump in and say thank you, Aisha, because it was really helpful because I missed a lot of it. Not being there in a lot of the scenes, I didn't know what was going on.
It's true. We put you on the bench for most of it, but that's only because Maddie, you were past your bedtime, and that's
true.
If your parents are going to parent you, we have to. Well done, Aisha. Appreciate that. Of course, MVP is only one of the ways that you can win experience points or gain experience points. The other way is the mid-game post. Halfway through this game, we're going to be stopping the action and posting to the stream with a question for you guys to answer. It'll be based on something that's happened in this episode, so make sure you pay attention. And if you win that, you'll get XP as well. And finally, end game XP. When this episode is done, we are going to be talking about who helped us the most. So if you want to be helpful, you start giving out your suggestions on the Facebook group page. It seems confusing, but the Facebook group, I guess. Give us your suggestions on where these guys should follow and where should they should head up and all that kind of stuff. I do want to mention before we get back into the game that next week we're taking a short break from Grimm and we are going to be playing a one-shot adventure. Should we tell them what this adventure is, Mike, or should we leave it up to... Let's hype them. Actually, we hype them.
We hype them? Okay. Let's so what we're going to do is we're going to revisit Mr. Barnabas Flintwick. Barnabas Flintwick?
Don't start with me. I have no idea.
I know. Grimlin and his little buddy Grimlin? Grimmin?
Grimlin. That's actually...
And like Milo...
Finnegan, wasn't it?
I don't know.
Milo
Finnegan. with just a short D&D 5e, nothing serious, just playing for fun, and let's hear some more music, because we got some really good ones last time with the Mom, Baby, Don't Mess Around.
Oh, that's right. I'll have to learn some new ukulele songs. So next week, we got D&D episode 3. And I think we might be having a special guest with that stream as well. So we'll see what happens.
I like how Mike said, we'll just be playing for fun next week. Whereas this week,
we're
playing for serious.
No fun anymore.
I just do this for the money.
Well, we do make a lot of money. I got to say, every lead you guys follow, I pay them $5. I'm like, hey guys, can you follow this lead, please? I will pay you. Anyway, so make sure you check out next week for D&D episode 3. We'll have to watch one of the old videos to remember how our characters go. Although I think Aisha probably did a best of video for one of those, so I'm sure we can just watch clips of that. Also, I need to bring my instrument so I remember to play it. Anyway, so that's next week. Again, a short break from Grimm. But tonight is all about Grimm, and we are excited to continue this mystery from where we left last week. So without further ado, one last reminder that if you are watching this, please like the video and share it with your friends, tweet it, share it on Facebook, whatever you want. I mean, again, we don't advertise, you know, we don't make you watch a 30-second ad. And we do that because we hope that you guys, if you like it enough, you'd share it. So please go ahead and do that because it makes us want to furiously touch ourselves. Without further ado, Grimm chapter, not in that way, Justin, Grimm chapter 3. Here we go. You stand in the dim light of the principal's office, a single solitary desk lamp lighting the room as you hear the distinct sound of the door lock behind you. The three of you stand almost motionless as Tam holds the bracelet in her open palm.
Guys, hide! And I gesture them to come and hide behind the desk.
So the door locked behind us?
The door locked
from the outside.
Well, it sounds like someone's coming in. Is it just locking?
Sounds like it's just locking. Do you want to hide them?
Well, are there windows? Like, is there like...
It is a windowless office.
Ooh.
And you can go back and check last episode because I made sure that was the case.
Okay. I checked the phone. I pick up the phone line. And what is Mattie doing?
Looking around to see if there's like one of those like stand up three prongy coat racks so that he can like tuck and cover behind a coat.
Okay. give me a luck roll, both of you.
Okay.
And Tam, you're hiding, so give me a hide roll if you want.
Sure. I think okay, I got a success at grade 2.
Success at a grade 2 of hiding. Yeah, easily you duck under the desk. You wheel the chair out and you duck under the desk.
Okay.
I succeeded luck at a grade 3 level.
Okay. And Mattie?
I see that the coat rack's there with no coats, but I stand behind it.
Okay.
The long pole.
That's the long pole. So two of you try to hide. Georgie snaps to the phone and picks it up. And as you do, Georgie, you said you succeeded at a grade 3 luck?
That's right.
You hear the voice on the telephone. And you don't recognize it at first. And you actually pick up the phone as it's mid-conversation. And you can hear someone in a deeper voice saying, "I don't know who, but I've locked him in the office. Get over here as soon as possible." And from the other side of the phone, you hear, "All right, just sit tight. We're going to send a squad car on its way, and we will investigate shortly. Can you make sure that they do not leave your office in any way? And he continues. And you realize suddenly that it's Principal Andrew actually making a call to the police station.
And I just say to the other guys, I whisper, that the police are coming.
Well, and I from behind the desk, get up, and I look at Georgie in the eye. I say, and I show him the bracelet. I say, Georgie, look what I found. The police, it's perfect.
Should we tell them? Should we tell them?
Well,
get your marbles, Tam.
I already have them. Show them the marbles.
It's us. It's us. We're here.
Georgie, shush, quiet.
So the conversation quickly stops. Hello, hello,
hello, cool. Sheriff, Sheriff.
And you hear the principal, hold on, do you have someone on your end picking up? No, there's no one on my end. It's on your end.
It's Principal Andrews. We found the bracelet in his drawer. You have to come
as soon
quickly.
As I hear that, I
what?
Push the desk towards the door. Georgie! And I start pushing it towards the door. He's going to come for us now.
Okay, so you shove the desk. Give me a muscle roll. Good luck. And you, Georgie, so you hear...
Mahogany is a light wood, right? Very,
the lightest.
It's like balsa.
What do you succeed?
I succeed at a, powerful grade young one. Tam succeeded at a muscle level of grade one.
So you push and your feet just slide out from behind you. You're just, and nothing's moving. And
Mattie, come help me. We got to get to the door quickly.
And Georgie, you hear sort of a bunch of confusion on the line, and the principal saying, hold on, what is going on? And the sheriff is sort of befuddled, and he says, we're sending a squad car on the way. Who is this? Stay on the phone, son. Where are you calling me from?
I'm in Principal Andrews. I'm in his office.
And you hear Principal Andrews say, God damn it. And he... And you hear him sort of set the phone.
What kind of door handle is it? Is it knob? Is it lever? Is it like a knob?
Yeah.
Just a knob.
Yeah. Okay. Well, remember, you're in the office,
yep.
Right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's no way you're locked in. It's because you have the key. I mean, it'd be a terribly designed office if they could lock in from the outside.
I imagine the door doesn't swing in either, does it?
The door swings. How do I want to do this? The door swings out.
Okay, so the barricading with the desk was probably a bad idea anyway.
Let's run for it, guys. Let's go. We got to get to the locker.
Now, who am I speaking with, son? We're sending a squad car right away.
My name is Georgie. Georgie Whitman.
Okay, Georgie.
Let's go.
Now, what are you doing in the principal's office, Georgie?
We came back for Tam's marbles, and we found a bracelet. Jane's bracelet.
You found Jane's bracelet.
It's
all right.
Here, and I'm gonna stay on the line. I'm gonna stay on the line until the squad car, because I think it's Mr. Andrews.
As they're talking, I'm getting nervous and going towards the door, and I reach into the bag of marbles and I whisper to them, and I start laying them on the floor in front of the door.
Okay. So you're whispering to your marbles and set them.
I'm putting a curse on them. Putting them in front of the door.
Let's do imagination. I'll let you roll imagination instead of luck for how this will work.
Okay.
Because I feel like magic.
What does that mean? I roll again? Do I roll again?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
That means you succeed at two grades below.
Okay, so grade 7.
It's grade 7. So you're 9 down to 8 down to 7 and you succeeded. Okay, so you succeeded at grade 7. All right. Mattie, what are you doing?
I'm looking around. I'm trying to get Georgie off the phone, and I was looking around to see,
let him.
I'm like, guys, let's go. We gotta book it. We can't stay here. We'll be trapped. We gotta get to the locker.
And I gesture for Mattie to come away from there and kind of hide against the wall, so that
we gotta get to the locker before the police get here.
Okay, Mattie, do you follow here, Mattie. Tam, or
I want to hide against the wall, so when the door swings in, we're hidden. The door swings.
It swings out. Right.
Yeah. Still.
But you can still stay hidden. It's a dimly lit office.
Yep. You gotta hide, Mattie.
I'm sure you won't see three kids.
Mattie, I can see you. Mattie, I can see you.
Oh my God, you're right. And so I jump behind the desk.
Okay, so now you're behind the desk, and Tam, you see him jump to the spot you just left. And George, you're still on the phone, and the sheriff is saying, "All right, son, look, there's no need to stay in the office. Principal Andrews can come in and talk to you."
Well, why is he locking us in here?
He's going to kill us.
Well, now when Principal Andrews called me, he wasn't aware that it was you in his office. He thought someone had broken in. So you have to understand that in this case, he followed proper procedure. And as he's talking,
he's a werewolf.
You hear the door unlock. And sure enough, it swings open. And Georgie, you see face to face with a steaming Principal Andrews.
He's here. He opened the door. He's here. He's like angry.
What on God's green? And he steps in. And Tam, give me a luck roll. This will be a grade, I'll say grade 3.
So, success.
Really?
Yeah, because I get 6 puts me to 3.
Nice. Okay, so he steps in, and what on God's green, and as his foot connects with the floor, he lands straight on your lucky black marble. And his foot goes sailing out from underneath him, and with a crack, he lands on his back, on another sea of marbles. God fucking, oh, damn it. Georgie.
Go, guys, go. And I run towards the door.
I jump over the principal
through the door, and I start running.
All right. So you jump over the principal, and you guys are now booking it down the hall. Mattie, give me a luck roll.
In what sense?
That you have to beat a grade 1.
No, sorry. I meant for what's the luck for? Because I might want to use my.
I want to see if you step on a marble accidentally.
I will go with that.
Because you were the farthest one, sort of from it. Yeah. It's going to be very easy, but.
Oh yeah!
Nice.
All right, so I succeed at a grade 4.
Okay, just for argument's sake, let's see. Yeah, so you jump over him and you all scamper out of the office as he sort of reaches up for you, trying to grab at your legs, but he just misses because he's also writhing in pain as the marbles are digging into his back. Oh, God damn it! You kids! And sure enough, you book it out into the hallway of the darkened school.
And we head towards the kindergarten area.
Okay.
But like as we're running, I go the wrong way at first and realize they went the wrong way and start catching up after kind of thing.
Perfect. Where are we going? So you run down one hall and you're sort of feeling in the dark with your arms out in front of you and you guys are running at breakneck speed. And finally, you reach the kindergarten wing of the middle school. Now, locker 125, which you know Luke told you, it sits in the shop area next to the kindergarten classrooms. And as you approach the end of the hall, you see the moonlight fighting its way through the clouds outside. It's beaming through the small windows at the end of the hall. And you can hear in the distance the bellowing of the principal as you hear the groan of thunder echo outside from the sky.
I quickly throw my backpack down onto the ground and I whip it open and pull out the crumpled piece of paper of my dad's locker combinations.
Perfect. So you snatch it out and as you do...
Did you see that? Holy cow, I cursed the marbles. It worked. I knew it would work.
Damn, I'm trying to concentrate.
But you know what, Georgie? I think maybe she's right. I think she is magical.
I am magical.
What's the combination? We have to figure that out.
Very quickly. I throw a marble at it.
Well, where's the paper?
Guys, stop it!
Roll luck, Tam.
A level 2.
Grade 3. Level 2?
Grade 2.
I'm going to say the marble rips through the paper as you toss it at it. It just pops right through. But it doesn't rip through where you needed it. There.
Like, sorry,
the combination is what?
No, Tam. Do a marble and just throw it randomly at the lockers.
No, I only have so many. Opens it. I put them back in my pocket. You can't abuse
Georgie,
it.
Georgie, you very quickly find the right combo and you start unlocking it as they continue to exist.
I'm surrounded by children. And I find the right combination and I start fumbling to put it in.
Okay, you guys can continue doing what you're doing.
I want to watch around to make sure Mr. Anderson's not coming. Oh, he's going to come, guys. I mean... I made him fall, but I don't think it's going to last.
Okay, Tam, so you sort of play lookout?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're looking out. Mattie, what are you doing?
I'm just looking at the door because I'm sure there's like a door nearby where they let the kindergartens out in and out of the playground. And I'm looking down the hall to see if Principal Andrews is coming. And I'm looking at Georgie to watch him open the lock. I'm just all over the place.
So you're sort of helping. You're just kind of looking all around. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I'm like,
perfect.
Oh,
okay, so
God, we're in so much trouble. I have my dad better not find out about this.
Georgie, you fumble with the locker. And sure enough, the final number clicks. And it falls loose in your hand. And you open the locker. And you take a quick breath. There, sitting in the bottom of the locker, is Jane's pink bag. The one that she was, her body was not found with, but the one that she was, she had left home with.
I hesitate for a moment, and then I grab it and turn back to the others and say, okay, Tam, Mattie, where do we go?
To the clubhouse!
As you do that, give me a seek roll.
Okay. And
it's going to be a great one. Ah, grade two.
Okay. So I turn back to the locker and I hand Mattie my flashlight and I say, Mattie, shine this on here.
What? And so, what? But I'm like, I'm shining.
It's all dancing around the corner. Like...
And I grab his arm and say, Mattie, focus. This is important. And I turn back to the locker.
So you can roll two die then if he's helping you.
Oh.
Okay, so that's only a level below. Roll again.
Okay. So I got a success at a grade three level.
Okay. Success. You very quickly grabbed the bag and almost missed it. But something in your brain said, hold on. And you turned back. You noticed a few pages beneath the bag. Almost purposely set beneath the base of the bag. And very quickly, you snatch them. As Tam, you see Principal Andrews turn the corner, a flashlight behind him.
The werewolf! Guys, we gotta go!
Okay! We start running down...
Well, now you know that the kindergarten is a dead end. Remember you made the joke, Mattie?
Do we have lockers?
Right. You do have lockers near the front of the school.
Oh, not near the kindergarten area at all.
Unfortunately.
Oh, shit. I did make a joke about that.
So you quickly turn the corner. Now, the lockers are sort of around the corner from the main hall that you're walking in. Basically, there's a long hall that ends in windows facing outside. And now you can hear that thunder echoing in the background. And it turns to face the kindergarten classroom. But again, there's sort of the door to the kindergarten classroom, and then there's the hall of lockers that you have here and the shop class on the opposite side.
I'm picturing like behind us view of a man with a flashlight staring at three kids with a bag hanging down, like looking at this thing. And
that's exactly it.
What are we going to do? What are we going to do?
Now, so does the kindergarten room have its own door to the outside?
You know what? I'll say yeah. Because
they often do, right?
Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. Sure. So, yeah.
So let's book it through there.
We have the key, right? Who has the key?
I've got the key. So I follow Mattie.
Okay. Give me the key, Georgie.
Okay.
And I'm looking at Principal Andrews as I'm doing it.
Now, this is going to be a competitive scamper test. So Mattie took the key. So Mattie, I want you to roll scamper higher than the grade I'm going to roll, which is going to end up being a grade four. Because he's walking, he's not running. If you ran it, you'd be
perfect. Dead. I'm going to use my social chameleon.
Okay.
And I'm going to use the jock. Okay. Winning play, which is by calling on some hidden reserve, the jock can push himself past normal limits. Once per scene, without spending his turn, the jock may gain a +1 grade to scamper, throw, and muscle tests.
Sounds good.
For the rest of the scene.
Perfect.
All right.
So now you just need to succeed at whatever that is. Is that six?
So that balances out, but I still get a +1 because of the...
Perfect. Well, six. What grade are you scamper normally?
Three. Holy shit.
No, that's it doesn't matter. What grade are you at scamper?
Three.
Okay, so the six allows you to go to level four, and the one at this point is not a detractor. So you succeed at level four.
Oh, okay.
And because you have the grade +1, you succeed at level five. So not only do you match him, which would have been bad, you succeed, which is very good. So almost instinctively, the key slides in on the first go, unlocks it, and the three of you are through the door as it slams shut behind you.
We all push in, like barely all getting through at the same time.
Yeah.
But I'm in such a rush, I don't take the key out of the door. I just pull the door open and go.
Perfect. So the key is now in the knob of the door. As you see behind you, almost seconds later, the glass window to the kindergarten room light up with a flashlight as you see Principal Andrews at the door. You kids, this is not funny.
And we just keep running towards the other exit door.
Okay. So you run towards the other exit door. And would it lock from the inside?
No, it would have to have a fire exit bar.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, it would. But I'm more thinking, would an alarm go off?
Yes.
Might help you, if anything. But fire alarms in 1982, pshaw. No, I'm just kidding. So sure enough, you run to the back door and you throw your body weight into it as a echoing ring sounds out throughout the entire school. Just a nonstop. And you are in a small sort of playpen area with an easily skippable fence of the kindergarten room.
Yeah. Let's go.
We run. We run a loop around.
Get our bikes.
School to get our bikes. But I stop the other two at the corner of the school just to look and make sure that the squad car hasn't arrived yet.
So you see the squad car out front.
And I kind of push past them like, Georgie, we don't have time. Let's get to the clubhouse.
Now your bikes are right next to the squad car out front of the school.
Leave the bikes. We don't have time. They'll get us.
Okay. And I run with them.
Okay. So you guys start running towards the clubhouse at top speed. And your lungs are burning and your muscles are pumping as you're just running faster than you've ever run before. And as you do, the thunder echoes in the sky and it begins lighting up around you as you feel almost a mystical energy flowing through you as you guys run.
Are we going to make it to the clubhouse before the skies open up?
Just keep running. Just keep running. We'll be okay.
You continue running, and sure enough, it does take you a lot longer on your feet, but you do eventually make it to the log. And the log is sitting over the river, which is running especially powerful for this time of night. It'll be grade two to get across. Grade two scamper. Again, you can aid each other, and you can step up or focus.
I'll help. Here, I'll hold the flashlight. You guys go first, then I'll throw you the flashlight. You hold it for me.
Okay. And Georgie's going to try it, but he's going to focus instead of doing teamwork.
Sure. And as Georgie's about to do it, I realize his shoelace is untied, and I bend down and I tie his shoelace.
Okay. Oh, thanks, Tim.
So you'll succeed at a 5 or a 6, Georgie.
Success at a level 1.
Okay. No, again, that's fine. So you stand on the log and you get about halfway through and you start to slip a little bit.
Careful.
But you take a breath and you continue on. I mean, this is something you've done 1,000 times. Succeeding at this doesn't necessarily mean you die. It means that you don't succeed easily.
Right. Okay. All right.
It's not a make or break fail type situation. Because again, there would be obviously leniency if you've done it a million times. If it was, you know. Anyway, Mattie, same with
Mattie, you're next. Mattie, remember you're feeling athletic right now too, by the way.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. I did succeed at a grade 4 level.
Perfect. You almost hop, skip, and jump across and land with both feet on the other side as you give a look to Georgie.
Good job, Mattie.
Thanks, Georgie.
Come on, Jam,
you can do it.
I throw Mattie the flashlight. And then I will try to get across.
Perfect.
Success at a level scamper?
Yeah.
Level 5.
Perfect. So yeah, you even better than Matt, you skip across the log.
a magic.
And you land. And as your feet plant on the other side, a massive earth-shattering thunderbolt just the sound just groans throughout the entire forest, and you feel it coax its way up your spine as you make your way to the clubhouse.
And as we're going there, Tam, you can hear me breathing really heavily and almost wheezing.
Did you bring your medicine?
I've got it, Tam. But I'm a convict now. They know my name. They know I was there. It's breaking and entering.
And you're going to be a dead convict. Take your medicine.
Okay, and I reach into my backpack and I grab my puffer and I...
And I grab it from him and I take a hit too.
Tam, you're not supposed to use that.
I feel good.
I snatch it back.
Perfect. So you make your way to the clubhouse as it sits against the jagged skyline of the sort of moonlit sky, and the blue lightning is rumbling throughout the clouds in the background. And as you approach it, again, it feels vacant and empty, more so than it ever has before at night. You guys have stayed here before, but something over the past weeks, months, has made this place feel almost religious in a sense, almost as if it's sacred to you guys. And you enter inside and light the small lamp so you can read the pages in the moonlight.
And I go right over to put on the tape.
We're like real detectives now. This is like real stuff. What is it? And,
you start playing a song, and Georgie walks over and obviously can't focus without music. And he slaps his hand down on the tape and stops it almost immediately.
Are you going to read it, Georgie, or should I?
Here. You read it, Tam.
It says...
Well, what you pull out, I'll do it this way. What you pull out, or what you pulled out of the locker, are three pages of what looks to be poetry, badly written poetry. The pen, the ink is sort of a light purple. There's little hearts drawn all over the pages. And again, they seem in no particular order.
Well, here's the first one, I guess. The stars shine bright, your eyes they felt, so real, and yet I can't help you. Since we, and look, she couldn't come up with a rhyme. It says bet and then met, but she didn't like that. And it says here, the day we met, you saw me there standing by the, she crossed out, stained redwood chair. If you don't feel the way I hope, there's not much I can do to cope. I wouldn't leave you if I tried. If you won't stay, I'd wish I died. Tell him tonight, it says underlined here. Oh, there's more. Look, he looks at me like I wished he had a man who makes me... For a long time, I didn't have a reason to behave bad. She crossed this out. She didn't like that part, I guess. The world may watch, the town may talk, but we care not for you. I'd walk to the end of the earth and beyond that, if only you knew. I love him so. I need him so. I want him so. The world may look at you and I as if we are not one. The partial tingling of my skin says that our days aren't done. When we are one, I cannot breathe. My lust I can't contain. Together in love. She crossed out, forevermore, our home at, what's this word, Georgie? Webby Lane. And if that home wants for more, then you and I will be together, held our endless love in matrimony. Tonight, I'll tell him.
Is that something on a bed?
No. George, explain it to him. Tonight, I'll tell him I wrote the letter. He'll stay with me words, or else he'll rhymes, burn, letter, words. I just love him. He'll stay with me forever. Together, we will be. It's not very good, is it?
It's
look at that.
stupid love stuff? Does it say who's like gross? Does it say who did it?
There's more, Tam. It says or else at the bottom. That's a little weird.
Oh, I was kind of crossed out.
Or else, like, or else I'm gonna gut you. I don't know.
Well, that's dark, Georgie.
Well, I don't know. I don't know, Jane. What about this other stuff? And I looked through the bag. So there was the pages from her diary, which is, I assume, what we're looking at.
Yeah. Well, there are pages at the bottom of the locker. You're not 100% sure if they're from the diary, but you can guess based on the paper.
Okay.
So you rifle through the bag, you start pulling out items, and you see a change of clothes, pajamas, a toothbrush, some makeup, and a few hairbands. Pink, purple, orange, red. Other than that, the bag is completely empty.
Hmm.
So, do we know of any place with a redwood chair?
Anything you want to check on the poem, give me a book learning or an imagination or however you want to justify it.
I want to do imagination. I want to see if I can see any significance that might be, you know, maybe, you know, girls and guys for that matter.
Sure. Yeah.
Sometimes hide things in meaning. So like the way that she, maybe she's using a code or something where she crosses out certain words. So I try to look at that.
But give me, it's going to be for specific points. So if you want specific points, you can roll for them, but it can't be a general.
Okay. So then my specific point would be, do I think there's something significant about the way that she's crossed out words on the poem? Sure.
Okay. It'll be a grade 2.
Success.
Okay. So you take a look at the crossed out words, and based on the way the rhyming is flowing, you kind of feel like it might just be based around the fact that she's trying to find words that fit.
It's like a rough draft.
Yeah, more of a rough draft than anything else. There does seem to be a few lines that are crossed out, but you can't make out what was written under them that might be significant, but there's no way to be able to see what it is. She was really scribbled over them. But other than that, you can't make anything out of it.
Georgie pulls the second sheet in front of him and squints at the Webby Lane part and kind of taps his chin. And I want to do a book learning.
Sure. It's going to be a grade 7.
Grade 7. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to focus.
Sure. Now remember, because it is one of your secondary skills, you can roll 2 die for it.
Right. My study skills.
The nerd is allowed to do 2 die for his study skills.
Success at a grade 9.
Perfect. Georgie takes the second sheet and looks over it with a puzzled face. Webby Lane doesn't sound familiar to you, Georgie, but Webb Lane does. Webb Lane is a road it's an old road, almost a dirt road. You think you've actually driven or rode past it before. It's on the main stretch of highway to get out of Harper's Hill, but it's rarely used. You don't know anything on it, and that's about all you know.
Is that close to the clubhouse?
No, it's on the other side of town. Okay. Oh, who's listening to the game?
I relay that to the other guys and say, okay, they could be talking about this web road.
Web Lane.
Maybe we could check that place out.
That's definitely a lead. Was there anything else you found in the locker?
No, that was it. Just the backpack. Here, you want one of these? And I hand one of the hairbands to Mattie.
Mattie, you take it.
Mattie, put it on.
Cool. Mattie ties his long blonde hair back into a ponytail.
I pull out the bracelet and I put it down on the table. Guys, I took this too.
Oh.
Well, we got to get that to the police. Let them know that the principal's a killer.
Yeah.
We got to save Georgie's dad.
I examined the bracelet. How does it look, Harlan? Anything bizarre?
Covered in your mucky little fingerprints. Put it this way, you picked it up with a bare hand. You carried it throughout your entire run. I mean,
Yeah. Oh, yeah. For sure. There's fingerprints on it. But yeah. What does it look like? Is it the same?
Oh, it's a very plain charm bracelet with a horseshoe on it. Had you not known it was Jane's or that the police were looking for it, you would have thought it was just a normal bracelet.
Yep. But I stand by what I did.
I'm not blaming you in the slightest.
What are we going to do? We have the evidence. We just got to go and tell them. They'll believe us. There's three of us. There's only one of him.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't know, guys. Georgie's looking really hesitant. He says, something about the way he was acting there didn't seem to me like maybe he was the one.
What do you mean? Yeah. He was angry.
He's a werewolf.
He's always Georgie. Angry.
He's the one.
He's always angry. And Tam, you don't know that.
Well, I'm pretty sure. Do you see how hairy his forearms are?
He's got a hairy forearms, but so does my dad. You're not saying he's a werewolf,
well,
are you?
He's the good werewolf.
Well,
werewolf. But still, he had the bracelet. Why would he have the bracelet? Is there any rule in our school about wearing jewelry or anything that he would confiscate a bracelet, Harlan? Because he's put in the same drawer he confiscated my marble. So is there some sort of rule that we know?
There's no rule that you know of, but you also know the principal is famous for taking things from kids he doesn't like when he's upset or angry at them or wants to teach a lesson.
Maybe, I don't know. Maybe he just took the bracelet because he caught Jane sneaking around the school at night.
You do notice something about the bracelet. It takes you a second because it's not a visual aspect of it. Tam, you pick it up, and as you're talking, you're playing with it, and you try to put it together.
It's broken.
And it's broken. It doesn't lock. The clasp has been bent.
It's been ripped off. Look, and I show him that the clasp doesn't go back together. That doesn't just happen.
Okay.
Now, how is it broken? Does it look like it's mangled broken?
Looks like it was, well, I mean, it's really tough to tell. Doesn't look like it was.
You know, it's hard to know if it was ripped off or if it fell.
Give me what variants of broken could mean.
Okay, but this is something that maybe I do have some training in because I have the industrial arts.
Okay, sure. That's a perfect example. Give me a roll for it. I'll make
so
it
a success. A grade 4 level.
Perfect. So you can tell that it was more than likely yanked off.
I love making jewelry, guys, and these clasps are solid. There's no way this would have come undone unless. And I look, show it. See how it says Italian there? That's good. That's the good stuff. It got ripped. It was broken.
Okay, Tam. So if that's the case, then him having it would mean very likely that he was the one who pulled it off.
Well, he could have found it, but he's a werewolf, so I commend. Oh, and then is it silver, Harlan?
It is silver.
Oh, no.
If it was silver, then how would he have gotten it in the drawer?
Exactly.
What am I saying?
He might have used like a handkerchief or something.
He's not.
To touch it.
You're right, Maddie.
Guys, let's just remember. Remember when we saw Mr. Ackerman today earlier?
And he said it was something supernatural.
He said it wasn't something supernatural because Jane wasn't killed by the same thing that killed the other people.
But he also said it should have stopped and Jane's cut. It was different.
Okay.
So maybe this is something new that he doesn't know about.
Maybe.
The thunder outside cracks.
I don't know.
As the three of you stand around the pages and the open knapsack.
Well, we still have Sarah we can talk to as well.
That's right. Sarah.
She works at the library.
Okay.
You know that on a night like tonight, 9 o'clock, especially with the curfew in effect, the library would no longer be open. As well as the tone that Ackerman gave you the information on Sarah, it was very dismissive. Interested as she might be, you got the impression that Ackerman and her had completed their jobs.
I began pacing back and forth in the clubhouse, trying to figure this out and say, okay, guys, all right, what are your ideas? So maybe he's a werewolf. That's one option. And I go to the bulletin board and I write on a sticky paper and pin it up.
Werewolf. Question mark.
And you get the feeling like, yeah, now you're thinking about this like a detective.
Okay.
And you get a sense of excitement in as you pin it to the board.
What happens? We know that, I don't want to say it, Georgie, but your dad, someone saw your dad with her. maybe your dad by accident broke it off, and then someone came and picked, that same person picked it up. Maybe it was Mr. Anderson.
Okay. Mr. Andrews.
Oh, it's Mr. Andrews. Mr. Anderson's a better werewolf name.
And I do another yellow paper. Any ideas, Maddie?
And I look to them, and I look at the tape, and I fast forward to something else. No, I think you guys are on the right track.
Okay, we also have Sarah and Mr. Ackerman. We should put them on the board somewhere.
Sarah and Ackerman. How do we do this? Okay, I want to do a book learning to see how a detective would go about this.
Sure.
What would be some logical steps? What information could I be piecing together?
Okay. Totally fair. You don't need to roll for it because this is something that you've read in books many times. And now that you're in this situation, you sort of just need to revamp. Obviously, recreating the night in question is the most important. You guys know that she was killed on the 28th. This was the same night that you guys left your houses and went down to see Amy Pope kissing Bobby Marlin.
She was killed at Blake Bridge Tunnel. We could go there.
Creating the night's important. The other thing to remember is recreating this scene of events. So if you're focusing on one situation, such as the bracelet, why would Andrews, you know, place it there is a question you want answered. You know, put yourself in the shoes of a killer is what you're now thinking, you know. You need to get rid of a piece of evidence that could be damning. Do you put it in your desk drawer? Do you burn it? Do you keep it in your pocket? Do you walk around with it? Or is it keeping as a charm? So recreating the nights, you're on the right track as you're trying to sort of go through the idea of how the bracelet landed there.
Could it be someone put it in his drawer to make him look like the killer? We know the cops were coming. They looked at the school before. Maybe some of the cops are werewolves.
Tam, it really frustrates me when you think that everybody is a werewolf.
Okay, killers.
We just have to think killers. That people are suspects, okay? Okay,
so what happens if the cops put it there?
But the cops are the good guys.
Some
the
are.
Cops aren't going to do it.
Okay, but you're on the right track. That's a good point. So why would Andrews call the cops if he knew that we were in the place where he hid the big piece of evidence?
You're probably right.
And as you say that, something that, Tam, that popped through your head rings true. And as you picked up the bracelet earlier and you regarded the clasps, the first thing that thought that went through your mind was, I wouldn't know this was important unless I had been told.
So who knew about the bracelet, right? Only, you know, it's only important because the bracelet, I knew about the bracelet because it was told about. We told a few other people, too. And I think of the dirty photographer. Would he be willing to plan something like this just to get a story? We should put him on the board just in case.
Okay. All right. That is Ed. What's his name? Edward? Eddie?
Parker Warren.
Parker Warren.
Close.
So close.
Parker Warren wanted to tell a story. He wanted a story for the paper.
Well, okay. And think about it like this. I know you think they're the good guys, Maddie, but there's been 5 people killed already. 6 now, right? With Jane?
Yeah, Jane is the 6th.
So if I was a police officer, it'd probably be pretty bad for my job. So maybe I would try to close the case and find a killer, even if it meant, well, I wouldn't do that, but maybe somebody else would, putting it in there. Is that possible? Or maybe they're one of the killers.
Because maybe, you know, not normally nothing happens here. Maybe they just want a job.
Which is why they would arrest Georgie's dad.
As you guys start speculating and you start spinning, Georgie, a line from Sherlock Holmes reeks into your brain. Put the facts before the theories, and you look at the board and you decide to write down what you know for certain.
I create a new note, and in big black letters, I write, Deputy Paul Hall. And I pin it up, and I look back at Tam, and I say, he was the one who told us about the bracelet. Now, that's a fact. We know that. Why did he tell us about the bracelet? Well, he said that it was because he thought that we were doing something good and that we were going to help. Where the seeing is believing agency, where, you know, we are wanting to help, but we're kids.
It is a little too coincidental that the one thing that he told us is the one thing we found.
That's right. And what else? So let's just think about this. Let's dwell on this. What else did he tell us?
He told us that we should start at the school. He told us to investigate the school. He was leading us there.
Do you think he's the one that put the bracelet in the principal's office?
He was also the one who... Sorry, Mattie. He might have been the one.
Right, but... because the police were there investigating.
And I quickly rummage through the bags and I pull out the pictures that... Or do we have the pictures that Parker gave us, or did he keep them?
No,
we don't.
Do I think back? Can I think if the deputy was in any of those pictures near the body?
Yeah, he was in most of them.
Was he near her wrist?
Well, again, her body was found without the...
Or is that something that he reported?
Well, that's what was reported.
But that's a good idea. The pictures. He also showed us the pictures of the symbol. The symbol that was found, or the mark that was found on all of the victims. Mm-hmm. That's gruesome stuff to show 10-year-olds, I think.
Parker Warren did show you the same. Just
he's a sleazebag.
Well, that is true.
Wait a second, though. Wait. Was it specifically reported that her bracelet was missing? Because that's weird. If you just came across a body, how would you know a bracelet is missing?
The mother was the one who said that she always had a bracelet on. And, well, this is what Paul Hall told us, at least. And also we've got Parker Warren to back that up, because Parker said he spoke with the mother as well. And he said the same thing. He knew about the bracelet.
Just out of curiosity, is there any relationship between the bracelet and the necklace that gives Luke his power? Like, do they look similar at all?
No.
Okay. Just out of curiosity.
Okay. So far,
the Deputy question
Hall had the opportunity.
Well, yeah. The question you asked yourself again, and this isn't, yeah. Everything is great. Don't get me wrong. But you remember that in a case of Sherlock Holmes that you've read over and over again, he reiterates that facts are not information that's given from another source, but facts are things that you yourself have accumulated and proven.
Right.
And you think back and you open the file and you pull out the facts that you guys have accumulated thus far.
Yeah, what do we have? Can you go over what the physical elements that we have?
Yeah, so you have Jane's diary page.
Okay.
And just... for ease, so you have Jane's diary page that talks about being happy. You have Jane's pages now, which speak of information that you've just learned. You have, let me pull the rest up here. You have an ink-stained page with a series of numbers on it. You also have... information about the crime scenes, which not necessarily because they're given to you, because they weren't hearsay, but they were things that you saw proof of, photos of, such as the symbol that was carved in the bodies. So these are sort of what you know, these are the basis of what you know. And every Sherlock Holmes case doesn't dismiss the information given to him by leads, that those are so important. But he always starts analyzing the irrefutable facts until they're done, and then moves on to what could be speculative.
Okay. So we know these things. We know that Jane's bracelet was broken.
She was meeting someone... she met him at a redwood chair, maybe Webb Lane. We don't know Webb.
And we know that he's older.
We know he's older, and Jane knew she had seen someone.
But now that isn't necessarily a fact. That was something that was told to us.
True.
By what's her face?
Right, but we should acknowledge the fact that there's this poetry and it seems like she's been meeting someone.
You're right.
So it's the poetry does make it's, we have physical evidence that she at least was imagining someone.
And it would be weird, and I gesture to the line that says that they don't care what people would think. The world may watch, the town may talk.
So what does that ring true to you?
That rings true that it would be a relationship that would be frowned on.
The police officer is not that much older than we are.
Okay.
He's young.
So you look at the cover that Luke drew, Who Killed Jane Lawrence, and you ask out loud, who do you think killed Jane Lawrence? Forget names. Describe the person.
Well, he'd have to be someone who has no soul. Someone who's, you can look into his eyes and you know that it's pure evil.
Okay.
But what does evil look like?
Under Who Killed?
He's someone that knows about the other murders, and he was close enough to the other murders to see the symbols.
And he hasn't been caught yet, so we know he's careful. He's very particular, and he's careful because he hasn't been caught. So maybe someone who's very clean and tidy.
And as you start theorizing, Georgie, these questions start ringing true. This is how Sherlock always solves his cases. He doesn't start naming people. He defines them. He starts using the facts to craft the setting and worries about who fits that setting at the end. And you each start getting excited as you start talking about what you know about or what you could speculate, but without putting a pin on it, what situation come about.
After not being found out by five murders, you might know how to cover your tracks really well. So how the police think. But I don't want to connect it too directly.
Yeah. Well, sorry. What are you saying with that? Are you saying that the person who killed Jane Lawrence is the same person who killed the other people?
No, that's true, because it is different.
We don't need to know about the other ones. We need to figure out who killed Jane.
This person knew about the other murders. There is a connection to those other murders. So
he knew about the other murders. He had access.
At least a copycat killer. Remember that story you read about a copycat killer?
Right, yeah. He had access to all the pictures. He was, whoever killed her knew how to recreate that mark that was found.
But not exactly.
But not exactly.
So.
That seems like a fact, right? Is that a fact, Maddie?
I think so, yeah, because it was different. And he also did it with a different thing. Because the other one, this one, I think, wasn't it not sharp? Wasn't it blunt? And it was more, you know.
Well, I'm just wondering.
So maybe someone who saw like a picture, but wasn't close enough to the other murders, right? Because if you saw the picture, you might see, okay, I can recreate that image with a little bit of imagination, but not enough detail to really be able to do it. Someone who saw, but didn't get a close enough look to know that it wasn't done in the same way.
He's also someone that I think wants to cover his tracks. He's someone who felt that the best place for the bracelet.
Why do you keep saying he? It could be a woman.
It could be a woman. You're right. The best place where the murderer felt that the bracelet should go is in Principal Andrews's desk.
Someone who had something against Principal Andrews.
And my mind.
So that's everyone at school.
Maddie did it. No.
And I laugh as I create another yellow slip and put up Mr. Edwards.
Why Mr. Edwards?
On the board.
I know that they don't seem to get along, but Mr. Edwards is... Now, is Mr. Edwards the teacher we like? Is that who you're talking about?
Yeah, he's the history teacher.
Mr. Edwards couldn't do it.
Well,
he gave me an A on my last paper.
I know.
It's true. It was like the first C+ I've ever gotten.
I know this isn't really how Sherlock Holmes does it, but something is saying Mr. Edwards to me because he didn't see eye to eye with the principal. He had access to the principal's office to put the bracelet.
He was in there. Maybe he.
Well, it's possible, but what else?
You know what?
What do we know?
Yeah. He was at the school. He could have seen your dad with her.
And you know what? You know what? He is our friend, so maybe he got a little too friendly with Jane.
And he's not much older than us, too, is he?
He's about 33, maybe. Mid-30s.
Huh.
Now, what does he teach again? Just history?
History.
Yep. He knows a lot about old things. So, if Mr. Arkansas, Mr. Ackers, no, Mr. Ackerman. Yeah, Mr. Ackerman. He said it's maybe this ritual thing. And although I like Mr. Edwards, he does know a lot about history. Maybe it's something historic in book learning.
The day we met, you saw me there, standing by the stained redwood chair. Do you think that that's literal?
Give me a book learning. Anybody? Okay.
I will help him.
Sure. Won't be tough.
And I will help too. I'll put on some good investigating music.
All right. So success at a grade 9.
Perfect. So you almost slap yourself on the forehead for not realizing it before. It doesn't seem significant because you pass by it almost every day, but there is a large stained redwood chair on the dock. And every year there's usually summer festivals where there's small pavilions set up and people walk around. So most likely what Jane's saying is she met someone there. Now, you know, it wouldn't be traceable per se, but it is an object in town.
Hmm. Okay. So it's possible that they met down by the dock.
We'll definitely have to go check that place out if we run out of leads. Okay. Why do you think Mr. Edwards?
Well, it was just an idea. Just because he has a possibility of fitting the description of someone who is, well, capable of doing the bracelet. But there was something else. Someone who knew Jane. Possibly. I don't know. And I say, talk to Mattie for a bit. I want to just concentrate on this poem a little bit.
And Tam, as you turn to Mattie, who's sort of just rewinding and playing his tape, trying not to think of the death of Jane, again, that you look at the bracelet, and again, you think, you know, you wouldn't know anything about this. It looks like a normal bracelet. And that sort of keeps repeating in your brain for a reason you don't know.
It looks like a normal bracelet. What do you mean? It's like a mundane bracelet kind of thing?
Well, you think about it, and you just sort of toy with it in your hand, and you think, you know, unless Parker Andrews or the police or
pointed it out
to you guys, you would have thought this was just a normal bracelet.
Now, it was the police who first pointed out to us, right?
Yeah, and then Parker Andrews sort of confirmed, or Parker Warren sort of confirmed it.
But Parker only knew because we told him about it.
No, he knew from Jane Lawrence's mother as well. No,
remember we said it's that, but not... Are we talking about the photographer? Because remember we misled him by saying it was a...
That's true.
A shamrock.
Oh, no, but he knew about the bracelet.
Ah, but he didn't know what was on.
Again, that, yeah, and that's even exactly sort of the point, that you wouldn't have known this from any other bracelet, that there was no reason.
How did Parker know about it? How did he confine... Like, how did he come across the information? What was the justification?
He said something about he confirmed it with Jane's mother. So it seems like he sort of sleazed around, like he probably did at the crime scenes, getting information at the source as well. You know he's a ruthless reporter and that he would talk anything.
Hmm. But would he take it? And I say this to Mattie. Mattie, do you think Parker would have taken it from her body to plant it? It doesn't seem like it makes sense if he talked to the mom about it first.
Why wouldn't it make sense?
Well, if it was me...
Because if he's just trying to dig up a story...
I wouldn't talk to the mom about it and then plant a bracelet. I would plant a bracelet. And have the mom or the police notice it.
But maybe he didn't know about the bracelet until he talked to the mom.
But you wouldn't talk to the mom about a bracelet if you didn't know what was missing. I mean, he might not have outright asked her, you know, does your daughter wear a bracelet? But he might have just talked to her and it came out.
But well, that's what I'm saying. Maybe he would do anything to sort of find that.
But that's what I'm saying. Maybe he was just there to talk to her. And then she said, I noticed that the bracelet's missing if you find the bracelet. And that's how he knew about the bracelet.
Right. So that would be after the fact. So then he'd have to find the bracelet in order to plant it.
Unless he already had it.
Why would he have it beforehand unless he was...
Because he wants a story.
No, he'd have to be the murderer to have it beforehand.
Right.
Or have some connection to Jane.
That's now, what I'm saying.
I think he's a sleazebag, Mattie, but I don't think he's a murderer. I don't think he has the guts. Now, my impression of him, is he sleazy? Do I think he's bold enough to do that kind of thing?
Parker Warren?
Yeah.
You don't know. I mean, you've seen him pay $5 here and there for you guys to give false reports. Oh, yeah, the old man, he marked up the cost of gum. You know, things like that. You've seen him do that. You've never partaken.
Okay, but let's think of the time of the events. My marbles were taken before I saw Parker. And then the bracelet was inside the drawer.
The bracelet was under the marbles, though. When you lifted up your bag of marbles, that's when you saw the bracelet.
But
and again, the bracelet was in with other things, other trinkets.
But when I said it was a shamrock, he didn't act that surprised. If he knew, if he had this bracelet, if he was going to plant this bracelet, I'm sure he would have known it was a horseshoe. Don't you think?
You're right, Tam. You're right. You're thinking you're right.
It's possible that he was fake bluffing, pretending that he didn't know anything about it.
I don't think he's that smart.
It was underneath. The marbles were on top.
Right.
But that means that it's a good chance that Mr. Anderson saw Mr. Andrews saw the bracelet. He saw the bracelet and then put the marbles on top. But
so that's why he's the killer.
But he's also a grumpy guy. He could have opened the drawer, thrown the marbles in, and slammed the door without even looking.
And it doesn't explain why he would have called the cops when the bracelet.
It does because he didn't want us to find the bracelet.
No, but
he's like, look, these kids are breaking in.
Occam's razor is a phrase that comes to mind, Georgie. And you turn to the board and you look at it. And the Occam's razor means often the simplest, most obvious answers are the correct one. You've never taken Principal Andrews as an evil man, per se. A simple man, maybe. He brought you into his office, and the tone when he confronted in the office wasn't embarrassed or vile or angry, caught. It was angry.
The same as it's always been.
I think he wouldn't have called the cops if he was the killer. Doesn't make sense. I would stay as far away from the police as I could.
Guys.
Who does that leave?
It's the deputy. And I reach up and I pull down the piece of paper and I bring it over to them. And I say, he crafted everything. He led us to believe everything. The only reason that we knew about the bracelet was because of him. The only reason we checked the school was because of him. The only reason... And Occam's razor.
I don't know what you're talking about, Georgie. You say things, sometimes they're not real.
He is pretty clean shaven, but that's because he's a policeman. But I don't know what that has to do with this.
I think it was him.
And a realization washes over you as you say it. But you know that without proof, going to the police with the idea of a police murderer is about the worst idea you can possibly do.
How do we go to the police on the police?
And you look down at the pages poured out, and you know that redwood stain, redwood chair would be a possible lead, if not tough. But Webby Lane, rings true, and you look back up at the board and see it written in thick ink.
I think this is the next step.
And as you say that,
does anyone live on it?
And shakes the house. No one you know lives lives on Web Lane. Again, it's almost abandoned. In fact, out of the three of you, only Georgie recognized the name purely because, again, he had passed by it one time.
Do you think they just go there so that they don't get seen by anybody? Do you think it'd be like a makeout spot?
Maddie.
Let's find out. If it's a makeout spot. I don't want to make out with you, Maddie.
What? Ew, gross. Gag me the spoon, Tam. No. We're friends.
Guys, seriously.
Let's go to Webby Lane.
Let's go to Web Lane, but I just want to say that this is scary. If I'm right, and I hope that I'm wrong, but if I'm right, and we go to the place that Jane was meeting with a killer, there's a chance that the killer will be there. And maybe it's the deputy, maybe we'll find out it's someone else, but I just want to say I love you guys, and we're going to do this. But I'm scared.
And as you each share a nervous look, understanding that this next step could be a fatal one, you take a strong breath and head towards your bikes. And we're going to stop it there for the mid-game post! Because that's sort of as good a natural ending or a mid-break as any, even though it's a bit early. That's right, your bikes are at school, so you have to figure that out.
Yeah.
Mid-game post. Again, this is a question that the first person to answer it is going to receive one XP. Now, there is the issue of timing on this kind of stuff, so maybe we'll figure out a solution in the future. But for now, it's still going to be the first answer for this question. So I'm going to post it right now. The question is, what locker number was Jane's locker?
I know this one.
I know you do. And I'll give it a second so that you can sort of remember and catch up to speed. And
I'm going to post 666, right?
Maybe that makes sense. Maybe if I wait a second, right? And then I post it? Does that ruin it? No, because you can think. That's fine. Okay, and I'm going to post it now. So hopefully if you're on a delay, you've heard the question and I can post it. Here we go. Ba-dam. Good. You guys enjoying the game?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. I would just like to say that before heading off, I would have gone to get my guitar strap whip.
Good, as you should. You keep it in the clubhouse, don't you?
Yeah, yeah.
Good.
Because that's where all our adventuring takes place.
Obviously. Perfect. Okay, and let's see. Tim Tabber says 231. That is incorrect, Tim. I'm sorry, that's not right. 8675309 says Dustin, also incorrect. Actually, you know what? I've been meaning to do this, and I'm so sorry, Dustin. I do want to mention, Dustin sent us a really nice Christmas card that came after Christmas, and from Chaosium, and I meant to post a picture of it, and I keep forgetting it. It's right here, so I'm going to do it now before I forget. It is a Call of Cthulhu. Meow, ho, 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 tep. Merry Christmas from Chaosium. And he says, Merry Christmas, Invictus Stream. May the green guy bring you all you want rather than all we mere humans deserve. Dustin Wright, the Chaosium guy. So thank you so much, Dustin. I'm so sorry about the delay. My wife said immediately, it only came like last week, and she said, oh, post pictures of it right away. And I was like, oh, yeah, I will. And then I brought it up here, and I totally forgot. So I apologize, but thank you so much. We love getting stuff like this. Oh, I think I just showed my address. I should probably blow that out. Well, that's fine. He just be safe with it. No, I'll blur that out. That's probably a bad idea. Worse that I said it. Never mind. Anyway, but we love getting stuff like that. We love getting mail like that. If you ever want to shoot us some mail, just shoot us an email at the InvictusStream@gmail.com, and I will give you an address that you can send stuff to. Because we love it. It's awesome. So thank you so much, Dustin. Michael Carl Weber got it correct. It was locker 125. I'm surprised that so little people got it right. I thought this would have been an easy one because last game with Nancy being Justin's mom's name, it took like a second. Mm-hmm. And this time I figured this was a lot easier, but I guess I only said it once. So well done, Michael. You win mid-game host. All right. And so without further ado, do you guys have anything quick to say or can we get back to it?
Thank you for the Christmas card.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Merry Christmas. Maybe it's like a super early Christmas card.
Everything for next year.
Yeah.
Could be. Not impossible.
Really proactive over at Chaos.
We don't got a lot going on now.
Perfect. All right. So you head to the school and to pick up your bikes. And sure enough, there are no cruisers out front by the time you arrive. And you very easily get your bikes from out front and head up to where you know Web Lane is. And Georgie guides you a bit. And you start heading up the road to the far side of town. And if you have the map of Harper's Hill, there's a road to the far right. And up there is where it leads to Web Lane. As you start pedaling up the long road north, it begins raining. The loud crack of thunder echoes and almost shakes you. It's now about 9:30 in the evening. The entire town is silent, and the warm January weather has sort of allowed for a brief bit of the freezing rain or the snow to stop, and it's letting this ice cold but wet droplets peck against your skin. Eventually, you reach the turnoff for Web Lane, as again, that rain begins pecking your shoulders like small, cold fingertips poking and prodding you. You each carry on with vigor through the turnoff as your bikes hit unearthed soil. The mud clings to your tires and begins drawing you to a stop. Give me a muscle roll, guys, or if you want to justify it in any other way.
I imagine I have muscles. No, okay. Can I do scamper? Would that work?
Sure, because you're pedaling.
Yeah. Uh-oh. So success at one level lower, so a level 4, I believe.
Okay, that's okay. I'm going to say you get through the muck. Mattie?
I'm still going to also use scamper, because I'm still getting a plus 1 to it, so I get a grade 4.
Well, how long is a scene? Isn't a scene like...
It's a... Oh, yeah, okay, that would be a scene. You're correct. Scene. Okay, grade 3.
Okay. I'll give that to you because it's a grade 3 difficulty.
Can I use Boy Scouts and ride on the edge of the path?
Sure, but it'll be a grade 5 difficulty.
It's funny how Georgie is the only one smart enough to do that.
He's a nerd. That's what he does.
It's okay, I still fail at a grade 4.
Okay, so... Sure enough, as you're approaching the turnoff for Web Lane, you skid through the mud, but you see Georgie fall behind as his bike just gets stuck and locked up with mud. By this time, the rain is now pounding down and pouring and soaking you guys through and through as you turn around and see Georgie stuck in the mud.
I get off of the bike, and I walk over beside him, and I bend down, and I put two fingers in the mud, and I go like this. I go, I guess we're going Rambo style. And I start popping out. Push his bike.
Okay.
Should we just leave and come back for these?
Yeah, I guess so.
Let's at least get it off the path. And I put it mine in a bush to like hide it.
Perfect.
Yeah, I do the same.
Yeah. So okay. So the three of you hide your bikes off the path as you approach the turnoff for Web Lane. It's a dirt road, something that you would have missed 1,000 times over had you not known previously, Georgie, that this was a path here. In your early days of book learning, you learned first and foremost about Harper Hill and all of its various sort of streets and all that kind of stuff. And this was one of the names that stuck and rung true to you in an excited way. You get up or get off the road and start trudging through the mud. And up a small hill, the drive almost disappears entirely, save for two tire treads. Years of a car or cars driving back and forth are the only road to speak of towards wherever you might be going.
You know, something else occurred to me. The deputy told us to wait before going to the school, not to go that night, to wait until the next morning.
Give them time to plant it, right?
Yeah. Just something crossed my mind.
And you're saying this as the rain is pouring down and you're each hiking up your jackets to cover the backs of your necks as you go down the crest of the hill and sort of slip a little bit in the wet mud. And you continue following the dirt road deep into the woods An I'm eerie actually, sense.
Sorry, I actually reach into the pocket and get the hair tie because I don't like the way my hair goes in my eyes when it's all wet, and I just put it all into like a ponytail that sticks straight up.
Perfect.
Is there any, how wide is this path? Is it a road?
Wide enough for a car. It's a earthen road. It looks like it's only designed by cars driving over it for years. There's no cement or stone or anything like that.
Okay.
Very natural road.
And Jane again, so, have, sorry.
Jane must have really liked this guy to come down here with him.
And you say, and as you say, you get an uncomfortable feeling imagining what sort of trouble got Jane killed.
Do you guys believe in Wendigos?
No.
No, I mean
either. Which way the wind goes?
No, Wendigos.
Yeah, which way the wind goes? I don't know. Don't you do this thing?
Any way the wind goes. Your clothes are now damp and cold, and they press against your skin like a thin, leathery hide, and a sense of uneasiness washes over you. And as you reach the top of the next muddy hill, you see it open up to a field in the distance. It almost beckons you forward. And as you head down, the clack of thunder illuminates a large field overgrown with stale corn and tall stalks that sit sharp against the thunder in the sky and lightning in the sky.
As Boy Scouts, am I afraid we're going to be hit by lightning?
No, it's in a distance. It's lighting the sky, the clouded sky, to give flashes of blue light throughout what you can see. But it doesn't seem to be striking anywhere near.
You said cornfields, right?
Yeah.
There must be a farm nearby.
And sure enough, as you head a little bit down the road, against the jagged backdrop of the forest, you see an old house with a large peaked roof and stained shingles. It looks ominous and unkempt, and it almost lurches forward as if towering over you as you guys slowly approach the middle area. Next to it sits a large red barn, its roof reaching high above the roof of the house. And with your back to the cornfield, you swallow hard as lightning ignites the sky in a sharp blue light.
Okay.
You have to really like some guy to go there.
Yeah.
Yeah, but girls do crazy things.
It's creepier than Hackman's house.
And I test the whip a couple times on branches.
And you do, and you're sort of doing it absentmindedly, Mattie, as the entire scene before you creeps you out. In fact, it scares you to a point that you're afraid to tell the others how you're feeling right now.
And I notice that Mattie has been very distant the past little while. He's been making jokes at inappropriate times, and I walk up to him, and it's what he always does. And I put my hand on his shoulder, and I say, Mattie, how are you feeling right now?
I'm good. We're together, and that's the important part. And we can do this, right? Because we are like cool kids incorporated. So,
yeah, like stuff like that. Like, you keep on making jokes, Mattie. You know this is serious, right? What we're doing.
I'm not gonna lie, Georgie. I'm pretty scared. I mean, number one, if my dad finds out what we've been up to and finds out that we like hurt the principal and we broke into the school. Like, I'm going to be in a lot of trouble. And then if it's the police, and the police are the bad guys, what do we call the feds? I don't know. Is that a thing we can do? Can we call the feds on the police? Do we call the CIA? Who do we call on the police?
I don't.
And then, like, we're walking in here, you know, to this creepy old house. I just,
Mattie, we're going to be there with you. As long as we stay together.
Well, I think it's important that we talk about this because this is scary. You're right. And I am scared. I'm scared too, Mattie.
You're scared too?
Yeah. I mean, like Ackerman's house, like it was just a house. Like it literally was just a house. It was creepy. But this is different.
And as you say that, thunder crackles through the sky as the rain continues pouring between the three of you as you continue on.
Tam. And I know Maddie's nervous, and I feel nervous myself. And I turn to Tam, whose hair is slick, drenched down, standing in the rain.
With some mud on my face from my from the rainbow.
And I say, Tam, what should we be thinking? What is there anything that you know that I don't know, that I can't see, that maybe will help us get through this?
And I reach into my pocket and I take out Lucas's necklace and I say, there's lots of things, Georgie, that go on in this world that we can't see. There's lots of things. And I take the necklace and I put it around his neck. Like the fact that we all love each other. People might not know that, but you, Lucas, Maddie, all of us, we're like family, even if we come from different families, if we come from different moms and dads. And I take a marble out of my pocket and I give it to Maddie and I give it to Georgie. And I say, I don't know if I have powers, but I know what's here is powerful. And the way that Lucas cared about his sister is powerful. And I think we'll be protected by that. And I give them a marble each and I say, these are powerful. I know that. And I give that to them.
I hold out my hand. It is, as the rain bounces off of it and I see the blue pearl in the palm of my hand and I slowly wrap my fingers around it.
The reason I know these are powerful, and I've never told anybody this, but I consider you guys my brothers. And there was a time my parents told me I was going to have a brother. And I didn't want a brother because I didn't want to share my parents. And I made a spell. I made a spell on these marbles that my mom gave me and said, your brother, it's the size of one of these marbles now. And I broke it with a hammer. My brother never came, and my mom, she cried for days, and it was my fault. I did that, and I have powers, and I got to know how to use them for good, and if I could take that back, I would. But now, I'm going to use it to protect you guys, and you guys will be safe because of my powers. My real brothers.
And the rain is pouring down as Tam stands before you, tears in her eyes. And thunder again just illuminates the sky and the lightning bathes the area in a soft blue light as she looks up to you.
And I'm thinking about Tam and the story that Tam just told, and I'm thinking about how she cursed the marbles and how it made the principal fall over, so make our escape. And I'm fully believing in Tam now. And so I put the marble in my pocket. I'm like, yeah, guys, we can do this. We got this. Tam's protecting us.
I grab Maddie's hand. I grab Georgie's hand. We'll do this together. For Lucas, for Jane. And I start.
And Georgie's dad. We got it.
Yeah. And as you three agree to that and nod, you turn towards the house and you approach. And you walk up the crooked steps of the porch. And as you stand, the rain drips off the overflowing drain. What's the...
eavesdrough?
Eavesdrough, thank you. The overflowing eavesdrough is trickling around you, almost creating a curtain that you walk through. And the three of you look to each other and enter the house as the creaking door echoes through the front hallway, which sits completely vacant. You step inside. The muffled raindrops peppering the roof far above you with a static-like white noise overhead. And between the walls, you hear the dripping of the rain, which eats through rotted parts of the house. The house looks completely vacant.
Is it dusty? Are there any footprints?
Give me a seek roll, level 2, grade 2.
Success.
at a grade 4.
You shine your large yellow light on the floor and sort of kick up a little bit of dust. And you see that there's bit, but it seems like it's a fairly used path.
Well, whoever lives here, this is where he would go.
Okay, and I kind of have my left hand in my pocket, playing around with the marble, rolling it around on my fingers, and I've got the kind of the tip of the whip stirring around the floor and watching the dust twirl up and make the patterns in the floor of the dust. And I'm looking at these two and thinking, okay, guys, yeah, we can do this. Where do you think they'd go? Do you think they'd go right to the bedroom?
Well, we have a path here, so let's follow the path. I don't think we really need to look anywhere else, do you?
So you take a look at the path, and you see it leads off into the house a bit. And sort of getting a feel for the house, to the left is a large, empty living room. There's no furniture in it. There's nothing in it, and it looks dust-covered. But to the right, just a bit way up, you can see what looks to be a countertop for a kitchen. And it also seems like maybe the stairs are used.
I look at the dust and where the footprints are.
Yeah.
I say, at least we know it's not a ghost. It's made tracks. It's just a regular person that's here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that fills me with a bit of courage as I decide to step into the kitchen. And is there a fridge?
There is.
I want to get an idea, thinking back to the Sherlock and thinking back to what we were talking about earlier. I want to get a feel for who this person is. So sure. I step up to the fridge and I open it. I look inside.
And it looks practically barren. There is an old jar of pickles on the counter. There's a few slices of processed cheese. And there's a half loaf of bread that looks to be ridden with mold.
Now, is the fridge cold? Because it's an abandoned house, or
no, it is not. There is no. It's in fact, it's an old fridge, like an icebox type fridge. Now you know, during the winter months, over the past 2 months, it wouldn't be too much of an issue because it's been cold out.
Hmm. I look at the pickles and the processed cheese and the moldy bread, and I say, "Oh, they say you are what you eat." And I close the fridge.
And you take a look around the kitchen and you see that the countertop has been wiped off relatively recently. Meaning there's no dust on it at all.
Looks like they've been using it in the kitchen.
That's weird.
So we've got to go upstairs next, don't we? Kind of look scared at the others.
And is there, like, I look at the windows, and is there any drapes on the window?
No, it looks like the house is almost completely stripped.
Oh. All right.
Okay. I'll go first. And it is upstairs the only other option?
There is a bathroom on this floor. I mean, you can pretty quickly sort of get a layout for the main floor. There's a bathroom. There doesn't seem to be a basement. There's the kitchen, the living room, and then another smaller room, which, again, is completely empty.
Hmm.
We're going to go together. We can't separate.
Right. Okay. Well, let's look at the bathroom.
Okay. So you just lean into the bathroom and you take a look. And it looks like the fixtures are pretty old. But there's no dust in the basin, the wash basin, nor the tub. There is water in the toilet. But other than that, there doesn't seem to be any utensils or
is there a towel or anything we can dry ourselves with?
Yeah, let's say there is.
I grab a towel and I quickly dry my hair.
Okay, you stop her. Perfect.
I'm just gonna dry my hair. It's soaking.
We don't know who's used that towel, Tam, and people aren't living in here. If they have a towel, it's not for their own. I just would say don't use it. I don't know.
I say okay, and I go over to the sink and at least wring my hair out in the sink.
Perfect. And big globs of wet water pour off your hair as you hear the rain just pouring down on the roof of the house. You can hear it dripping on the floors above you.
And as I lift my head up into the window and I think, or into the mirror, and I think, It's possible that the person who killed Jane looks in this mirror every day. I wonder what he sees. I say this out loud. I wonder who he sees looking back.
Give me a seek roll, Tam.
Success.
At grade?
4.
Okay. No, you don't see anything.
As Tam's doing this, I don't respond, but I stick my head out in the hallway to look to the front door. And it dawns on me that the rain is so loud that we wouldn't hear anybody come in.
Did you shut the door behind you?
And I go to do that, to do exactly that.
So you leave the bathroom, which is sort of behind the stairs, and you walk towards the front door. And as you approach it, you get an eerie sense, just an uneasiness. And step by step, you come closer to the door. And through the flashes of blue light outside, it illuminates the path out front. And nothing stands between you and the vast cornfield on the far side of the lot. But as you do, you get an eerie sense of familiarity from the corn. But you reach the door and you shut it.
And is there a lock?
There is.
I lock it.
Okay. And a voice says, good. No, it's kidding. Perfect. No, you feel confident that there's no basement to this house and that this is the main floor.
Okay, guys. Should we go upstairs?
Together.
And I roll the marble around in my pocket a few more times. Oh, okay.
Step by step, you make your way up to the second floor, and the house creaks and groans. Its ancient bones giving way to your steps as you approach the top. And as you do, and you stand there in the dimly lit hallway, which is illuminated every so often with the flashes of light from outside, you see two rooms on either side and a bathroom as well.
Okay. What way does the path lead?
It's tough to tell at this point. It looks well used up here.
Okay. Well, I just arbitrarily pick the room to the left.
So you turn towards that and the door
is open. I stop him.
Okay.
What? What is it, Tam?
I don't know. I just... I don't know if that's the right way to go. I think we should... just be careful. And I think there's danger in that room.
Okay. All right. You might be right. And I take a look at the doors and the thresholds and just the area around the door just to see if there's anything. And I say to the others, take a look and make sure there aren't any traps. If this is the killer's house, maybe he'd want to protect whatever he's working on.
Give me a seek roll.
Okay, with teamwork?
Sure.
Okay. Yay!
So the 6 levels up?
Yep, so success at a grade 5.
Okay, so you look around the door frame. Everything seems to be pretty normal. In fact, as you're standing in the doorway to the room to the left, you look in and you see that this room is empty. And in fact, it looks like there's a thick layer of dust on the ground.
Okay. All right. And then to the next room, the one in the middle.
All right. This door is shut.
Okay. Is the other door not shut?
No, it was open. The one that you just checked.
No, the bathroom.
Oh, sorry. The bathroom is open. You know, it's the bathroom.
Okay. So I just stick my head in the bathroom and see if it's anything like the other one.
It looks very similar. There is no tub. It's just sort of a toilet and a sink. Give me a seek roll. I assume you're kind of all moving together, so you can give me a combined seek roll if someone wants to.
Okay, Tam, why don't you take this one? I'll shine the light.
And I will stay out in the hallway, kind of with like the one hand in my pocket rolling the marble, the other one kind of with the whip ready to go.
Okay.
So a grade 4 seek success.
Okay.
Now, is there a way to, instead of just extra die? Is there a way to just boost your numbers if we...
Yeah, remember, you can always step up, which just means
perform
at one grade higher.
But we got to take your time to do it.
Yeah.
No, just focus.
Step-ups is instantaneous. Focusing takes time. It takes one round, and it lowers the bar to five.
See, to me, I would almost always take stepping up. When can you not take step-up?
You can always take step-up. The problem is you can only ever perform only one grade above, meaning if it's higher, you won't succeed.
But your likelihood of getting more than one grade above is like a 1 in 36.
What do you mean?
Well, you'd have to roll a 6 and then another 6.
Well, what I mean is if something was in this room at a grade 7 level, stepping up would never work because it doesn't matter. You'd only ever perform at a grade 5, right?
Okay.
Whereas teamwork gives you the chance to getting a 7, and focusing gives you a chance at getting a 7.
Right. Okay, so a grade 4 level seek.
Okay, so no, you don't. Well, you know what?
Can we say I stepped up? Okay, grade 5?
Sure. Tam, you look in this bathroom with the light of Georgie's flashlight shining, and you almost lean back before you notice something. And you lean back out, and you see, sitting on the wash basin, just behind the taps, an orange hairband.
And I grab the hairband from Maddie's hair without saying anything and pull it out. And I look at it.
Oh, Tam!
And then I walk over and grab the other one.
And I drop the whip instantly to grab where my head is sore and marble in my pocket.
And I compare the two. Are they the same make or the same color?
They're from the same packet.
I look back at Georgie and I look back at Maddie and said, Jane was here.
Ow.
The wash basin, right? And I look closer into the wash basin. Is there any sign of anything grotesque?
No. It looks like it's been used.
Yeah. Any hair?
Yeah.
Still attached to the
long hairs. Okay. Anyone who's lived with a woman can attest.
Yeah, that's the worst.
Is the seat up or down?
It's up.
It's not a gentleman who lives here.
Yeah, because I look at that because I know JR would kill me if I left the seat up.
The kitchen downstairs, was it very industrial or was it more of a standard kitchen?
Standard kitchen. Looked like it was around when the house was built.
Okay.
Did Jane's bag have a mirror in it?
It did not.
No, okay. All right, so I look to the other two and I look to the last door that is closed.
You look to the last door, that thunderous crack of thunder echoes again through the house, shaking its bones.
It seems that every time I'm about to make a very dark, difficult decision...
And before you answer, another crack of thunder carries itself.
Pathetic.
You realize that it's the last room up here, and step by step, you approach the door.
And I grab my whip from the ground, and I also look around just to look up as he's doing that, just to see if there's an attic.
There does not seem to be, no. No, it seems to be. And as you approach this door, there's a drip coming from straight above it.
And I go along don't let it touch you. And I go along the edges of the wall.
And showing rare superstition, Georgie follows Tam's lead.
And you're standing in front of the door.
I'm about to open it, but then I take my hand and I put it inside my shirt. Okay. To protect from fingerprints, and then I...
For sure.
Slowly put it around the handle, look to the others, and turn it.
And as the door creaks open, it reveals a window leading to the forest behind the house. A large oak cabinet and nothing else.
Okay.
The room is completely empty.
That's weird. Because if they were coming here to, date, wouldn't there be, at least a mattress or a sleeping bag somewhere?
I don't know. And I shine a light around this door again just to make sure that there isn't anything.
You shine a light around, and sure enough, there doesn't seem to be anything. In fact, there's dust caked on the floor in this room as well.
I go to the cabinet at least to open it up. Oh, I might as well look what's in here.
Well, cabin hold on.
Completely empty.
Oh. It's completely empty.
Yeah. In fact, the shelves are removed from it. It's just a large vacant.
I don't know what I expected. I closed the door.
So I stepped.
And it shuts with a loud, loud clatter.
And I stepped to the window. That was loud. Quiet, Tam. And I look out on the rainy evening.
So there's two windows in this room, sorry. There's one facing the woods behind, and you look out to see again the clouded sky and the streaks of lightning piercing through. You see the dense, thick trees behind the house. And as you turn to the other window, you see the barn. The large red barn sitting with its roof almost higher than the house that you're currently in.
Well, we've got one more room to check, guys.
We also have... Well, we should check that one more room, and then... Are we going to go to that barn?
There was only two rooms up here and a bathroom.
Well, there was the one room that was empty. Is that what you're talking about, Justin?
No. No, it was the barn.
Oh, the barn. I see.
But I look at the window, and I look... Is there a roof underneath the window, like a ledge?
It is there, but it's at the front of the house.
At the front of the house. So yes. None of the windows you'd be able to open up.
No, none of these windows look like you'd be able to get out from. Well, you could jump, but it'd be a two-story drop.
Okay. Based on the house, is there possible there's a secret door behind the cabinet?
The wall behind the cabinet borders the bathroom. So
it would go to the bathroom, if anything. Yeah.
It's about...
Go to plumbing.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Nothing odd strikes you about the house. It seems like a house that was once well lived in, but for whatever reason was abandoned. Most likely because the cornfield was no longer tended to or cared for or not needed. You expect with each turn of the knob, each step in the creaking wooden floorboards for something to reveal itself, and yet it doesn't.
I don't want to go as much as you guys do, but we all know we can't leave any stone unturned. We got to go to the barn. And I started heading out the door. I said, let's stay together. We'll stay safe.
Okay. We got to go to the town. We need to have some piece of information that can pin it on whoever did this. But I'm thinking, Tam, and I stop her as she starts going down the stairs.
Georgie, you're always thinking.
I know, but. If it was the deputy, just let's entertain that.
And you're saying this as you're walking downstairs.
Yeah. If it was the deputy, he told us everything that we needed to get here. He literally led us through all of the motions to get us. And now we're here, which, you know, he could have figured out.
Well, you're right.
Maybe he wants us touching things and screwing things up because he thinks we're stupid kids.
Do you think that he would have put that in the locker too? He probably would have had access to the locker.
Now remember, no one knew about the locker. Luke was the only one who knew. Luke was the person who told you.
What do you mean no one knew about the locker?
The deputy
have known about the locker.
Well, the deputy mentioned that they searched her locker. Remember, Jane doesn't go to the middle school you go to.
They searched her high school locker.
Exactly. Luke was the one, upon hearing the news, that said Jane also had a locker because she tutored
kindergarten.
Right.
Okay. So never mind. You're right. The officer doesn't know that we know about Webb Lane.
Right. But I wouldn't be surprised if. We are in danger. I feel like we're in danger. So you never know.
Yeah, you're right. He could figure it out. The locker was left open, so he could figure out that we were in Jane's locker.
And as you're standing there by the front door, the rain again continually patters down beside you.
And I'm like using the whip to try to flick at like the light switch. And try to hit it, but I'm always like off by like.
Hey, and I grab his wrist.
What?
I say, we're in this together.
Yes, I know.
Hang on, guys, and I run to the kitchen and I pull open the drawers and see if there's a knife or something I can grab.
Yep.
So I grab a knife. Yeah. Is there a couple knives?
There are.
So I grab three knives.
There is a set of steak knives.
Yeah, so I grabbed three steak knives, little like steak knives.
Well, perfect, because of the set of four, there are only three there.
Okay, so I bring them to the guys and I say, I don't know. And I hand them one each and I put one in my boot going down.
Okay.
This is what he uses to cut his processed cheese and pickles.
Well, the kitchen is relatively stocked. I mean, there's pots and pans as well and things like that.
Oh, okay.
Okay. All just right. In case, guys.
And you take a deep breath and you head out into the rain. The barn sits tall and ominous in the heavy rain as you approach its large red doors. A chill reaches up your spine as thunder bellows through the farm, loud enough to feel within your core. On the outside of the doors, you see a large padlock, but it looks relatively new.
Oh,
someone doesn't want us to get in here.
Hey, what about the diary? Do you think that the inky page is combinations for this? And I look at the lock.
It's a keyed padlock.
Oh, never mind. There must be another way into the barn.
Well, this is also a farm. There's probably a shed sitting around back of the house.
Like a shovel or anything that we need, just a pickaxe, something to hit it.
Yeah.
Somebody look for something heavy, a rock, anything, a shed, something.
Put it this way, without dwelling on it too much, the three of you quickly start looking. And leaning up against the side of the house is a small shack, just covered with a simple tin roof. In there, there's a basin for collecting water, and sure enough, a crowbar sits there.
I grab it, and I hand it to Tam, who's stronger than I am.
I look it down, look at it, and I go... I shake my head and I hand it to Mattie, who Mattie is wandering around still looking for a rock.
Yeah.
Where's Mattie? We need his help.
Okay, well, I'll try.
And as you're standing there in the rain, George, your eyes sort of settle on the cornfield and you get an eerie sense of deja vu.
The corn.
That festival you talked about, Harlan, was it a corn festival?
No, it was just a waterfront festival.
Okay.
Can I do a book learning? Maybe it's something I read in a book.
I'll tell you right now, because it hits you like a ton of bricks. You had a dream not two nights ago.
Right. Oh, right. The corn. And I look up at Tam, and I look at my yellow flashlight.
And you can see me like looking at the lock, looking at the pickaxe, looking at him. I go... Looking like I'm about to swing.
And Mattie comes back into the scene after looking.
Oh, thank goodness. As you can see me struggling with it, I said, Mattie, you do this. It's grunt work.
And Mattie, you take the crowbar, and sure enough, with one fail swoop, you unlock the padlock on the barn doors, and they slide open a little bit.
Wow.
That was pretty awesome.
And now I'm like weighing my whip made out of a guitar strap or the crowbar. And I just kind of wrap my whip and like open my belt, undo my belt so I can put it through the whip so it stays at my belt, tie it up, and I'll just, yeah, this feels better.
Sounds good. Sure enough, you pull the large doors of the barn open and enter inside to get out of the rain. You notice the walls to the left and right of you in the barn entryway. Most barns don't have this, but for whatever reason, there are two sides. And the smell of dry corn and hay infuses within your nostrils as you step inside. You can still see the roof far above you, but before you is a sheet with a split down the middle.
A split?
Like a cut sheet.
When the lightning strikes and has it stricken?
You wait a minute, and sure enough, it lights up.
And does it show a silhouette behind the sheet?
It does not. The light pierces through the tall windows in the barn. And you see something behind the sheet, but not a figure.
Knowing that Georgie suffers from allergies and the dust and stuff, I reach into his backpack and I hand him his puffer and say, just in case. And I walk towards the sheet.
So you walk towards the sheet and part it with your hand. And slowly as you pull back the parted sheet, the blue lightning illuminates the room from behind and above you. And what you see before you isn't just a barn, but almost a home. At first, you get an odd sense that it's almost inviting. Its large ceiling feels almost cathedral-esque, and the soft wood beneath your feet offers a slight give, as if it was almost carpeted. Sheets are hung, not just from where you pass, but as makeshift room dividers. Frilly white sheets with pink flowers, large colorful pillows sort of line the corners, as if it were decorated to be a home. And you pull back the sheet to reveal it to the other two, as Mattie, absentmindedly playing around with things, flicks on a light switch. And sure enough, dotted lights illuminate the barn.
What is this?
This is the makeout place.
What do you think it is? Do you think it's where he lives? I say as I step in and I turn off my flashlight.
You step in, and again, large light bulbs are strung from rafters. The sheets, again, sort of separating areas, and it looks homey.
I start walking through the different areas.
So you walk to your left. Start
coming into my head as I'm looking through the things.
And you pull back. You pull back an area, and you see behind a bed sheet, there's a mattress on the floor, well used, with melted candles around it, and a small record player with a record positioned on top of it.
I go over the record and lift it up to see what it is.
It's Peter, Paul, and Mary.
And I put it on. I turn it on.
As you do, a song echoes through the barn. Hush-a-bye, don't you cry. It's a sweet and somber melody that sort of fills you with sadness, oddly enough. And the album is called In the Wind. The three of them are standing on it, sort of arm in arm, holding guitar. And the song reverberates off the walls of the barn as it sends an eerie chill up your spine to the point where you awkwardly look back at Georgie and Mattie.
As I hear the music, I start thinking to myself, and I look at Mattie and I say, imagination is a very powerful thing, Mattie.
Well,
powerful enough to trick your heart into believing things that aren't true, to feeling things that aren't true.
What do you mean, Tam?
I just know if someone got a hold of my imagination, I don't know what I would be capable of or what I would believe. Looking around this room thinking a madman has taken hold of a young girl's imagination and used it against her. I keep looking through the different places, and as I finish that sentence, I go to the next room and I look around. And I do a seek roll to see if there's any evidence or clues.
So Georgie and Mattie follow you as you look into the next room, and the next room looks to be a makeshift dining area. Wow.
You just totally Justin James that.
So it's a good thing I didn't step up that time.
All right.
A grade 7.
Okay. As you enter the dining area, you notice something. Running from the corner, past through the next dividing line, is an extension cord. And curiosity gets the better of you as you reach under the next cord, which seems to be sort of a clothing area where they are keeping their clothes, men's, women's clothes, two various sizes. But the extension cord runs under a carpet, and it seems to disappear. Throwing back the carpet as Georgie and Mattie follow you, as the thunder echoes outside and the rain beats down on the roof high above you, you see a hatch in the floor.
we're all there, or this is just Tam?
All of you.
I would wait there until you guys came to me anyways.
Okay.
And as you see Tam standing over the hatch in the floor, she looks up to the two of you with a dreaded look in her eyes.
Well, do you think... I guess we gotta. And
I stop Mattie and say, things worse than trolls can live underground, Mattie.
And I step back and I again take a moment to play with the marble in my pocket, which kind of makes me drop the crowbar a little bit and it thuds on the floor.
And sure enough, you hear a hollow sound beneath the floor.
And I'm like, it's okay, Tam. We got your marbles. And I go to pull open the door.
And you do, with a loud creak, you throw the hatch back, revealing a small set of wooden stairs leading to a dark cellar.
Do you got your flashlight, Georgie?
Yeah, I got it. And shakingly, I take it up front.
Did you notice, was there any police clothes in the clothing piles?
They look to be just average clothes. Yeah. They're neatly folded, too. I mean, it's sort of a storage. Yeah. The smell of sweet, freshly tilled earth comes out from the cellar as Hushabye continues playing in the background. And one by one, you head down the steps into the darkness, the wood giving ever so softly beneath your feet. And as you enter the dark basement, you see a short path leading to a large area, the walls lined with heavy stones supporting the floor above you.
And I kind of like squat down on the steps as we're going down. So I'm actually like kind of sitting on my bum and going down because I'm thinking about like for Christmas this year, my dad is the only thing for the whole family because it was like $800 and he got us a VCR for the family. Lucky. And we could rent VHS tapes. And I've been watching like horror movies I know my mom wouldn't want me to watch. But I'm always thinking about like walking down the stairs and someone grabbing the feet and falling forward. So I just actually
squat my way down. Okay. Well, you can see that the back is just stone as well. So
I still don't trust it.
You shine your flashlight down the stone hallway. And as you continue, you see in the larger area what looks to be sort of a bulletin board. And a table, not a sinister table, not a blood-soaked, hacked-up cleaver fest of a table, but a simple working table. A desk, almost.
Is there paper on it?
There is. In fact, there's large boxes stacked next to the table as well.
I curiously start walking towards it.
The three of you approach and look at it, and the empty pin board has the pins neatly tucked to one side, the boxes sitting some on the table, some on the floor. And as you open the boxes, your blood runs cold. Sitting on top of the boxes, you see a drawing of the symbol. Pictures of the previous victims, before and after they were found killed, newspaper clippings, headlines, everything about the murders, and through the clash of thunder, you hear a frail voice behind you, a voice that you missed, that stepped into the barn and followed you down the steps. Kids? Slowly, you turn around to see a shadowy figure standing at the foot of the steps. For a moment, you each stand frozen. Time slows to a crawl, and you can hear rain softly hitting the roof high above you. Between the clashes of thunder, in the distance, you hear the soft dripping off the figure's coat as they take a step towards into the light of the basement. And there, before you, standing drenched from head to toe, is your teacher, Thomas Edwards. His voice quivers. How did you guys find this?
What does it all mean? What does it mean, Mr. Edwards?
Why do you have this stuff, Mr. Edwards?
Kids, this is stuff you wouldn't understand. This is...
You need to explain it to us, Mr. Edwards. Why do you have this box?
Let's do some cool rolls. Or rolls however you want to do it. However you want to play this out.
Personally, why don't we start off with...
Well, why don't we do this? Why don't we start off with how you guys are going to play this, and then let's see how we're going to make that happen.
As soon as Mr. Edwards comes into the room, I want to back away from him.
Okay.
To make some space, because I don't trust this man.
So he's standing at the end of the stone hallway leading to the only stairs that you can see exit. And you're now standing in a larger opening area, again, stone wall, dirt floor of what looked to be his planning area. And there seems to be no exit.
And I back towards the wall away from him.
Okay.
Because I'm not going to get through a grown adult, push my way through. So I back away like a cornered animal.
Okay. So you take a step back.
I repeat what I said. I said, Mr. Edwards, what is this box? And I'll do a cold roll to see how he reacts to that.
Okay.
Like I said, you know, I don't know.
And Georgie, Maddie, what are you guys doing? Georgie can't speak, or Maddie can't speak. He's overcome with fear.
Well, I am also overcome with fear, and my... cool is not the greatest. So I'm trying to think of something creative. So Maddie, why don't you, you have any ideas?
I do. Again, seeing the figure there, and I'm playing with the marble that Tam gave me, and I'm thinking about the way that Tam said, you know, we are family, regardless of parents. And I'm thinking about Luke, and I'm thinking about Jane. And I'm going full barbarian and just running. No, you're never going to hurt her. And I just swing the crowbar.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my pluck, my being brave, so I can automatically fail or succeed at the brave skill.
Okay.
And I'm going to use, if it works, my David and Goliath, which is whenever I'm facing an opponent whose stature is larger than me, I get a +1 attack. On attack tests against the opponent.
Okay.
And now the stature rules were kind of strange. Is he a different stature?
Yes, he'd be a normal sized person.
Okay. That's why I didn't know if it would work, but let's do that.
Okay. So you're going to scrap with him then?
I guess so, yes.
Okay.
And what would I do? Was it step it up or what was the other one? I'll just step it up right now.
I'm not sure if those work on attacking. Let's see, though. So you have to be within reach. So you're going to run at him and then attack.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you roll your scrap then, and he rolls his defense.
Okay. All right. This would be a good time to Justin James this.
Come on. Nice. I send you my blessing. Nice.
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 All right. So that would be +1 for the David and Goliath. So that would bring me to a 4, a grade 5, a grade 6. So is that grade 7 then?
So grade 7.
Grade 7.
So yeah, so you run at him, and he, as you swing back going to hit him, he grabs the bar in your hand. He's an adult, right? So
yeah,
like everything he's got.
Well, that's why I was going. Yeah, but that's why I was going for the knees.
Okay, well, he grabs it at the knee.
Yeah.
So he grabs it from you, and you can see as you approach, you see his eyes are pained. You know, he's saying almost through tears, through as his breath quivers as you swing at his knees, and he stops you. He says, "Oh man, no, not listen. It's not how it's supposed to go." What happened? He pulls it from you, and let's see. Oh, so he pulls it from you at a grade 11 muscle.
So if you can, I guess, match a grade 11 muscle, then you
not even it. Close. Yeah, okay. Not even close.
So he very easily pulls it from you. And he says, guys.
Mr. Edwards, you have all of these papers here. And I just want to know what happened. You don't seem happy.
Sorry. He looks at you, and again through red eyes. You can almost tell that this has been weighing on him. But this means the end of his life. So I'm going to need a really convincing role. Teamwork works for this. Stepping up works for this. But essentially, this is a very difficult.
I kind of want to take a different approach.
Sure, let's do it.
Because I know that Mr. Edwards is a historian.
He is.
And he's got all of these papers. I don't think that he just has these papers for the purpose of covering up Jane's death. I think that he's actually legitimately interested in something.
Maybe he's researching, trying to figure it out for himself.
Yeah, so I want to turn around and look at the papers. And I want to use book learning.
Okay.
To see whether or not I'm able to discern what he's going for and whether or not I can use that information to leverage.
Sure. So I'll let you sort of do it. I mean, he doesn't seem to be actively attacking you.
Yeah.
You know in your soul that this is not a difficult fight for him. Prime example, Jane. It's terrible that sounds. So this is something that Georgie, with quick thinking, you get that idea and you spin around at the table and you take a quick look at them. It doesn't take you long. So give me your book learning roll.
I'm going to step up.
Okay. So you'll automatically achieve at level 10.
10.
Which is a good call. You take a quick look at it, and based on the information provided, at first you can't quite place it. It seems like he was researching the murders, maybe for interest, but what didn't make sense is why he would be using the pin board, why he would need a place hidden to invest interest. You know, if this was something that he wanted to help solve, he could easily go to the police. And that's when it dawns on you, no, this was purely because he wanted to hide Jane's death in a series of unexplained deaths. And you turn back to Mr. Edwards with the knowledge that he did with intent kill Jane. And this was purely research to ensure that he wouldn't get caught.
Oh, Mr. Edwards. Oh, Mr. Edwards. And I look down.
And it gets to him a bit. This is his students. These are his students, people that he's admired, people that he's respected. And you know, above all else, that you three have been sort of the top of his class, which is why his voice quivers so when he first said something at the end of that hall. And he looks to you, and he looks to you, Tam, and he looks to you, Mattie, as you sort of kneel before him or sit before him. And you can see him almost searching between your faces for something.
If you're looking for sympathy, Mr. Edwards, you're not going to find it from us. We care about Lucas. What you did to Jane is not okay.
Tam.
And he looks down and he says, I know. I know it's not okay. I know that.
Then why don't you turn yourself in?
Oh my God, kids. I thought about it. I thought about it so many times.
It's not too late, Mr. Edwards. You don't have to do this. And I think of the fact that there's three of us in this room with a murderer. Let us do it. Let us take the evidence. If you're not strong enough, we can be.
And you can see he's running all the variants in his mind. If he kills you three, where we hide you, if he convinces you that he's innocent, you know, what could he say? You know, and he's running them all very quickly in his mind, as you've seen him 1,000 times do at the front of the class, thinking of options. And you know Edwards is a smart man, but you also know that you've caught him off guard and you have a chance at something.
But what?
Well, is it like a chance that he's off guard, so maybe we can...
I don't think so. There's something that we're missing.
Well, do you think he loved Jane? What about Lucas? And what was the relationship between Lucas and him?
Just as good as the three of you.
You pretend like you care about us in class. You pretend that you care about our futures. What kind of future have you left for Lucas? He was close to his sister. He loved his sister.
Sting him.
You're a monster. You're worse than any of those people we read about.
I am a monster. And your intended jab actually strikes the wrong way you wanted it to. I am a monster, aren't I? And you can see as he slowly starts sort of nodding to himself.
Mr. Edwards, right now my dad, I know this has got to be a hard situation for you. And you seem to like us in class. I really don't think that you can let anything go on like this, but...
And you see as you're talking, his face is still sort of nodding to his own confirmation. No, Tam's right. I think I am a monster.
You're not a monster, Mr. Edwards. You're not. You're not. You're a good teacher. You helped get us out of trouble. You're a good man. And I think somewhere along the way you got lost. And you made
what are you saying, Georgie?
I'm saying he made a mistake. And now he's trying to cover it up.
A mistake is, oops, I stubbed my toe. Oops, I spilled some milk. That's not a mistake,
Georgie. Damn, shut up! Shut up! He made a mistake, okay?
I think you're right. And you see him reach behind his back. And he pulls out a gun and looks at it almost, maybe regretfully, as if you could tell he's been carrying it for a long time.
Are there lights on down here?
No, it's pretty dim. In fact, the only light would be your flashlight.
And maybe some light coming from the stairs from the...
And the stairs from behind him, yeah.
And I start making my way behind the desk.
Now the desk is tucked against a corner.
Oh, I see.
But you don't have a wrong idea here. You are currently the only light source in the basement.
And what is he doing with the gun?
He's looking at it right now. You can tell every thought he's taking, he's giving many chances for anything to happen.
I look at Mattie.
Mattie, after failing to hit him and seeing how easily he grabbed it, I kind of crumpled on the ground and I'm just kind of like there and I kind of crying. And as soon as he pulls out the gun, I do wet myself a little and I kind of shuffle backwards on my butt to try to get closer to you guys. But other than that, I've been pretty like just trying to hold back tears up until this point.
Georgie, it's us or him. He's going to kill us, or he's going to kill himself. Let him do it. He's a monster.
And he hears that, because it's pretty close.
I did try to whisper it to, I know it didn't come across, but I did try to whisper it to him.
We'll do a seek. We'll play fairly. And he hears that a grade 12.
So he's got power in his ears, change directions.
Well, he's above grade 12. He's literally a teacher.
Your hearing goes down as you get older.
I'm going to look at Mattie on the floor, and I look to Tam. My heart is racing, and I look to Mr. Edwards with the gun, and I say, well, I don't see any other way out of this. And I walk straight up to Mr. Edwards, a foot away from him.
Okay.
And I say, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. I look at Mr. Edwards.
Yeah. Right in the eye. Give me a pluck roll.
Oh, my heart actually is racing.
That's a damn good move.
Yeah. Until you get brain splattered across you.
Okay, so I'm focusing. Can I focus at this time, or should I just do, because I'm so scared?
Step it up.
You can step it up or focus, however you want.
I'll focus.
Step it up.
Okay.
And my pluck is my main core trait. What does that mean again?
That means you can
spend points, but we're not sure how that works.
Yeah, we never really did that. You can do really important things on it. Maybe you can roll 2d6. I think that's it. No, I don't remember. You can upgrade it. Well, what's your thing?
It's my talents.
You know who
would know?
Paul would know.
Paul would know.
Paul Warren?
No.
Paul Hall?
Paul Hall. I'm sorry, Mark Lane would know because he's been reading the books. Mark Lane, what does the iconic trait do?
I wrote it all down, though we never used it until now.
The most.
Well, if you've got an iconic trait, then it actually, you'll get an extra benefit with it. So, like, for example, I have pluck as my iconic trait, which means I can be brave successfully once per scene.
Oh, I see. So it's just an automatic success for you.
For me, yeah, but I don't know what to...
Pluck is my automatic win, or my iconic as well.
Oh, okay. Well, that's what it is. You can automatically succeed at being brave.
Okay.
You just spend your...
Well, that's points literally there. Exactly...
But you have to lower your... you have to lower your pluck to do it.
All right, let's not...
Okay.
Yeah, let's not worry too much about
make
that.
Make a call on it.
That's perfect, though. Okay, so you're being brave, so you automatically succeed. So what's your grade? Your grade is 6, so you automatically succeed at a grade higher. So you automatically succeed grade 7. So tell me what happens.
Okay. So I walk across the floor towards Mr. Edwards. I stop right in front of him, flashlight still in my hand, and I look up at him and make direct eye contact with him. And just wait for his move.
Nice.
And I'm readying something.
And you see him begin to cry. And the gun in his hand is shaking. And you can see him sort of put it to your forehead. But as he does, you can see something in his eyes. And you lock eyes with him. And you can see the wavering behind him. And he falls to his knees. And you hear him. And the gun falls. Next to you, Mattie.
And I, like, as I'm trying to scoot back more, I kick it further.
And he says, she came to me. She's so strong. She said it would be secret, and it was. And then she threatened to tell everyone. And he just starts blubbering. And sure enough, he begins telling you everything that happened between him and Jane.
And
leaving the gory details.
Oh, okay.
Now, when you did pass through the main house, in the kitchen on the wall, there was a phone.
Okay. So I look to the others. I look to Tam and Mattie. And gesture for them to move.
I walk over and I grab the box of evidence.
Okay. And you see him sort of look up with pained eyes at you doing it, and almost ashamed, he looks away down at the ground.
And I walk around him like it's something disgusting on the floor, like vomit or something that I'm seeing, and I'm just walking around him. And I go up the stairs.
And I get to my feet and try to smudge some of the dirt from the basement floor onto my pants to make it look like I didn't pee myself. Cover that up as I pick up the gun shakily.
Okay. So, Mattie, you grab the gun and you head up to the barn as Georgie...
But no, I kind of step back and have it ready to make sure that Georgie's safe.
Perfect. And Georgie, you lean against the wall across from Mr. Edwards, who has his head in his hands, his knees curled up to his chest as he leans against the wall. I'm so sorry, Jim. I'm so sorry, Jim. He just says on repeat.
And I look to Mattie and I look back to Mr. Edwards and shake my head. And I want to say something, but I stop myself and walk past him.
Tam heads upstairs, heads to the house through the pouring rain, and phones the police, and heads back to the three of you as you watch Edwards. The police sirens cut through the thunder and rain as you see Mr. Edwards crying in his lap. And after a beat, the sound of the rapidly flapping windshield wipers and the sliding of wet tires on muddy ground come into earshot as well. Through slow blinks, you see the police enter. Before you know what happens, they've pulled Mr. Edwards up from the cellar, put him on the floor of the changing room, and handcuffed him behind his back as his tears set hollowly against the wooden floor. Through the next blink, you're being led outside into the rain. Another blink, and you can feel the warm, soft blanket being wrapped around each of your shivering bodies. Now, 3-4 squad cars pull up. Deputy Paul Hall looks at you, again with a pained look, a knowing look. And he nods. You blink again, and you're in the back of the deputy's car. Soft music sounds on the radio, a familiar song. Hushabye by Peter, Paul, and Mary. Before the car pulls away, you see Mr. Edwards being led out of the barn into the back of another one of the squad cars. They're reading him his rights. He shakes his head. No, he says, I didn't kill the others. Blink. As you sit once again in the police station on the blue bench, the bench you once shared, the clacking of the typewriter punches through your mind, and blink, suddenly you look up and you see the sheriff standing above you, the three of you sitting side by side, shivering, wet, with the blanket still around you. Thank you for your statements, kids, the sheriff says with a pained face. Your parents are going to be here soon to pick you up. We've had the deputy grab your bikes from the farm as well. They're out front for your parents to take home. And you can see him fight the urge to press you for more. But your statement's already taken. He steps away. You don't recall what you said. You remember telling him what went down. He begins walking away, and after a few paces, he stops. Just glad Luke wasn't there to see that. I know he was a fan of Mr. Edwards, and knowing that Edwards killed Jane, well, I'm sure he's heard the news by now. Can't imagine he'll take it well. You wait for your kids, and he heads to the back and enters his office as the three of you wait on the blue bench.
And I'm kind of dangling my feet, and in clasp in my hands, I've got the marble that Tam gave me, and I can't help but think about the cornfield and about how I'd felt that deja vu. And for a minute, I felt that I was, that the dream meant something, that these dreams that I've been having actually were significant in some way, and was starting to believe Tam. But now I see that the world is as stark and gray as I originally once thought it to be, as Mr. Edwards is in custody. And I put the marble back in my pocket and think of it just as a token from a friend.
And as you do, the words of the sheriff echo through you. I'm sure Luke knows about Edwards by now, and the words Luke said to you yesterday about how if he knew it was a real person, he would take his own life atop the clubhouse. They sink into you.
That's right. Tam, Mattie, what about Luke?
We need to let him know it was a monster. We need to find Luke before it's... We gotta get to the clubhouse.
And without wasting a moment, you throw your blankets down and run outside to your bikes. You jump on your bikes. You know time is of the essence as the rain picks up again. You ride towards the clubhouse. Every muscle in your tired bodies burn as you pump the bike pedals harder and harder. Tears and rain mix together as the now sleeted rain stings your face as you whip past the school. And by the time you reach the woods, the rain is almost frozen. You reach the log. Who goes first?
I'll go. I make my way across.
Okay. Give me a scamper roll.
Success at a level one.
Perfect. And you head across the log. Mattie.
Yep. Sorry. I lost my dice stream. Hang on just a second.
We trust you.
No, I mean, I lost time. Oh, there we go. Yeah, no problem.
Okay.
Still third grade. Yeah.
Knowing that Luke is more than likely standing on top of the steep, on top of the clubhouse, Georgie heads across the log, and Mattie, anxious to save his friend Luke, jumps on as well. Tam, you stand on the side, about to go over. And then you hear nothing. Not the rushing water below, nor the wind through the trees. All you can hear is the heavy, damp cracking of the log, which Mattie and Georgie stand on. Their screams cut through the night, and suddenly the rushing waters and wind pierce your ears as if they're the first sounds you've ever heard. You leap forward, and as you do, the wet ground gives beneath your feet as you fall down into the icy waters of the river below, joining Mattie and Georgie, and all goes black. Tam, you sputter up water as you open your eyes to the dimly lit shore next to the river. The shore is covered with wet sand. You stand up in the now clear night sky. The icy cold wind rustles the trees around you as you brush yourself off and feel the cold sink within your wet clothes. In the dark, your eyes begin to adjust as the trees creak and groan around you as if laughing. Slowly, you walk towards the waterfront, your bare feet against the cold, wet sand. Where the shore meets the water, you see your shoe.
I pick it up.
And as you do, as you stoop down to pick up the shoe, you look up to the water, and you see two young figures floating face down, Mattie and Georgie. For a moment, you stand there, unable to move. Their bodies float listlessly, caught on a log, unmoving, save for the breeze, which pushes them over and over again into the shore. Almost instinctively, you wait for the sound. A sound which seems familiar. A kerplunk to the right of you. And as fear overwhelms you, you turn slowly to your right. In the still of the night, with the frostbitten trees brushing softly behind you, you turn to see a dark figure standing on the riverfront, skipping stones.
Your breath blooms in the cold as you shiver in the darkness. After another kerplunk, the tall figure turns towards you and begins walking down the beach to you. As the moonlight cuts between the trees, illuminating the figure, you see him, a pale man in an ash suit, slowly walking towards you, his face pale and gaunt, his gray hair disheveled as if combed by hand. He stops, bends down, and with his elongated fingers, he scoops up a stone off the beach, throws it towards the river, which you notice for the first time is unmoving. You look up just above your head to see large, fat snowflakes falling, but slower than you've ever seen them before, almost as if time has stopped. And looking back down, you see the man is now before you, staring at you. A large smile, a toothy grin, as if his teeth are too many for his mouth, plastered on his face. I like you, Tam. I think you're clever. I think you're witty and smart, and I think you make good decisions. I love giving second chances. I promised only a short time ago that I would make no more requests, no more deals, but this is something special. He looks towards the dead bodies of Georgie and Mattie that float face down in the water. So I'll make you a deal. Tam, you stand wet and shivering in the moonlight, and he takes a deep breath of the cold air. Leave this town. Leave everything behind you, and I'll bring them back. I'll even bring back Luke, who's long since jumped to his death. I think everyone, at one point or another, deserves a second chance. But they're not without cost. And again, his toothy grin smiles, sending a chill up your spine as your clothes stick to your skin and your hair sits damp and wet on your shoulders. I think it's a fair deal, and the only one that I think you're going to get. And smiling, he holds his long-fingered hand out in front of him. Deal?
I reach my stoked hand towards his and shake it.
Damn, you're a smart girl. You're a clever girl. I've always liked you. He smiles a toothy grin and backs away from you, skipping as he does. As he walks out of view, you hear him from a distance. Tam, I want you to know that in the beginning, there was me on this side and life on yours. And he turns around and disappears into the darkness. And so the murder stopped. As the snow began to fall faster, time caught up with itself. Mattie and Georgie both sputtered up water, climbing up from the soaking riverfront. Upon reaching the clubhouse, the three of them found Luke sitting on the ground in tears, having survived his fall from the top of the old church. Tam explained to them what happened on the riverfront that night. And for better or for worse, each of them left the woods with a new view of the universe, a deeper understanding of what lies beneath the cracks of this world, a world that would forever seem a bit darker. It would be an injustice to say that the murders that took place over the winter of 1982 were solved. However, with a little help, four young children, the police were able to solve the death of Jane Lawrence.
And while the police never did find a connection between the previous five victims and James' murderer, the middle school teacher known as Thomas Edwards, they were given enough proof in his farmhouse to put him away for life. And so, as the weather warmed in the winter of 1982 passed, so did the unknown force that inhabited the lives of the four children of Harper's Hill. The end. Or so it seemed to be. If you take I-17 north of Arkham, just past Orchard's Run, before the turnoff towards the cracked and crooked mansion of 17 Miller Lane, you'll come across a sign for a small town called Harper's Hill. There was a time the town was overcome by a dark and unknown presence, a presence that viciously and brutally murdered five children. However, this is no longer that time. Those days are 35 years since passed, and the small hamlet of Harper's Hill has experienced some of the most fruitful and carefree years of its existence. Warmth and companionship beam from every citizen in Harper's Hill, and the grand old oak tree sits as strong and as proud as ever at the top of Harper's Hill in the year 2017. Though the accounts would vary depending on the source, the murders that took place in 1982 were solved with the help of four young children: George Whitman, now a business analyst working in Arkham; Matthew Michael, a police officer; Tamrick Moonshine, an independent business owner; and Luke Lawrence, the only one of the four who ended up staying in the small town of Harper's Hill. Over the years, the four of you failed to keep in touch. The occasional phone call would come once a week, then once a year. And now, as you each enter your late 40s, even more rarely do you get the chance to catch up. Part of you wish to forget. Part of you fear there's little you have in common anymore. Regardless, you each know that forever you will hold a special bond that brought you together that winter in 82. Tam, you return home from a long weekend away. Entering your kitchen, you see the light on your home phone illuminated with a missed call, and without thought, you press it.
Please leave a message after the tone.
Hey, Tam. It's Luke. I never blamed you guys for leaving. I thought about leaving myself. A lot. But I want you to know I never blamed you for what happened 35 years ago. What you did, the choice you made on the riverbank. It took me a long time to understand what it meant. But I never stopped looking. Tam, Ackerman was wrong. He didn't stop it all those years ago, not entirely. It's going to return, and we're the only ones that can stop it. You, me, Georgie, Mattie. Come back and help me stop this thing once and for all. Together we can do it. Together we can do anything.
As the message finishes playing, you stand in the kitchen, still wearing your coat. You listen to the entirety of his voicemail. His voice rings out in the kitchen. You think back on your time in Harper's Hill and the mostly fond memories you hold of that place, as well as Luke. His message ends, and you hear the loud beep of another message. A few days later, this time from a familiar voice as well.
Hey, Tam. It's Georgie. Listen. Luke is dead. I'm sorry. Call me back.
And we are going to end it there. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been GRIMM Chapter 3. When we come back, there's going to be a lot of changes. First and foremost, we are no longer playing GRIMM. This was always intended to be a Call of Cthulhu adventure, and these characters are going to write up their characters 35 years in the future with the histories we have established in these first three episodes and see how they affected the murders that happened all those years ago. So I hope you enjoy what's coming up. Secondly, we have a big old end of game XP to award to somebody in the group. Did you guys find any particularly useful comments to help you on tonight's quest?
I got to say, Lauren Reagan was very helpful. She had a lot of great posts. That would be my
nomination. Do you want to give Lorraine then?
I would like to give it to Lorraine. Yeah.
I will not argue that.
Let's not overthink it.
I will not argue that. Yep.
Let's not overthink it. Lorraine Rinregan, you win the endgame XP. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been a blast so far. GRIMM is a fantastic system. I love it to death, and I love these characters. And this was something that I designed from the beginning to really give a bit of backstory to find out exactly what happens. A lot of things are going to come back up, and it's going to be a crazy adventure in the following weeks. However, we are taking next week off, and now you might understand why, to roll up new characters. So, or at least new stats. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for hanging out with us tonight. Please check out the podcast if you have not, and if you can, go ahead and give it a 5-star rating or whatever you think is fair. Anything higher than 4 is fair. And also make sure to like this video on YouTube because it means the world to us. Thank you guys so much. That is all from me. And as Chris always likes to say,
see you around the table.
We will see you around the table. Guys, good night.